It's time for Twit This Week in Tech. We've got a preview of tomorrow's big WWDC keynote, what Apple may say, what Apple may not say. We'll also talk about virtual reality, augmented reality, and we'll learn a whole lot about the future. It's coming up next on Twit.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for This Week in Tech is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com. This is Twit, This Week in Tech, episode 513, recorded Sunday, June 7th, 2015. Bathed in structured light. This Week in Tech is brought to you by the Ring Video Doorbell. With Ring, you can see and talk to anyone at your door from anywhere in the world using your smartphone. It's like caller ID for your house. Get $25 off the Ring Video Doorbell when you go to ring.com/twit. And by Citrix GoToMeeting, the powerfully simple way to meet with coworkers and clients from the convenience of your computer, smartphone, or tablet. Share the same screen and see each other face-to-face with HD video conferencing. For a 30-day free trial, visit gotomeeting.com today. And by Squarespace. Start building your website today at squarespace.com. Enter the offer code TWIT at checkout to get 10% off. Squarespace. Build it beautiful. And by Casper, an online retailer of premium mattresses for a fraction of the price. Because everyone deserves a great night's sleep. Get $50 off any mattress purchase by visiting casper.com/twit and entering the promo code TWIT. Twit. It's time for Twit This Week in Tech, the show where we cover the week's tech news with experts who can explain what it means to me. Basically, I'm the idiot here. We're glad, very glad, as always, to have Jill Duffy joining us via Skype from where? New York, right, Jill?
I'm in New York today. I'm in Washington, D.C. usually.
Oh, that's right. You've moved your base of operations to Washington. Jill writes for PC Magazine. Somebody still writes for PC Magazine, I'm happy to say. It's online at PCMag.com. We also have with us Steve Kovach. Great to have you back. Normally, you're back. You moved back east.
Yeah, I'm usually Skyping in from New York like Jill, but... I got to come out.
You're out here for
in person
for the Mac event, the Apple event.
I'm WWDC. Here for Apple and some other cool meetings out here. Yeah,
Steve, senior editor for Business Insider. Actually, you senior editor for SAI, which is the tech section.
Yeah.
What's that stand for?
It's Silicon Alley Insider. So when BI first started back in 07.
That was Calacanis's publication, wasn't it?
No, Henry Blodgett.
Blodgett.
Yeah.
Okay.
Still
cool.
is.
Yeah. Well, not Business Insider. Yeah. Well, nice to have you.
Kind of morphed into that.
And an old friend is here, not really a tech journalist, but a guy who certainly knows a lot about what's going on in technology, Greg Panos. Nice to see you.
Yeah, great.
I've told the story many times about running into you at CES a few years ago, and you said, you know, we could do Dev Null, the virtual reality character I used to inhabit
right
on the site in the mid-90s. We could do that on a PC today.
Oh, yeah. We could do it on the smartphone. I have an app that's working on the phone.
So
it's called Intel Pocket Avatar.
Isn't that hysterical? Yeah, we bought a $500,000 Silicon Graphics Onyx.
Right, Reality Engine.
Yeah, and Protozoa made the character.
Yeah, Brad DeGraff's company.
And somebody, I think I met Brad in a men's room. Mm-hmm. I know where it was. It was at the Webby's. Mm-hmm. He said, you know, I still have Dev on a hard drive somewhere.
Yeah,
right. So that character could come back, ladies and gentlemen, on a smartphone. Weird.
Yeah, well, we called it performance animation, and it was really hard to get people in the industry to adopt it because a lot of vendors were trying to sell motion capture hardware. So they would always refer to it as motion capture, which is really not a live performance. You perform live, and then it's recorded and tweaked. But performance animation, you set it up, and then you just perform, and the character is performed and animated live.
It was a real-time virtual character.
Real-time, yeah. It's a lot harder to do.
That's why MSNBC wanted it, is because Soledad O'Brien could sit at the coffee bar, which mm-hmm. was real. She right. was real, as far as I know. And she would sit at the coffee bar, stare at a dot, but she could hear me. She had an earpiece in, mm-hmm. so I'd talk to her. But instead of seeing the dot, the viewers at home would see a virtual character, Steph right. Null, animate. There he is. The most annoying.
He's the author, TV that is good.
I take credit for it being annoying. And the technology was a little primitive.
Right.
But it worked.
Yeah, it did
and,
work.
And the thing is, it worked in real time. So you didn't have to, you didn't go back and like spend days, weeks, months, years animating Dev Null.
Right. There were a couple of companies that were really ruled the roost in that whole area.
But it's so ugly. But do you think nowadays you could make it look more realistic?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Yeah, there's a, I don't know if you've seen Baby X, but that's a research project that Mark Sagar has been doing in New Zealand with the University of Auckland. And
it's creepy as hell. I mean, talk about uncanny valley.
He digitized his daughter, and then they built a complete brain model of a child, and it reacts and responds with a webcam. It can listen to you. It can recognize characters or photographs of animals, and it's really cute. I mean, the little baby animation is all done in real time. It's all run by a virtual AI brain model. So it learns.
He's smart, though, because one of the problems with AIs is they aren't adult humans. But a baby, you might be able to impersonate a baby, a small child.
No, it's very effective. There's a couple of YouTubes out there showing Baby X with him interacting with the virtual baby, and it's just mind-blowing.
That is just... It is a little bit of the uncanny valley.
So they're up to 3.0 now.
Yeah.
The baby was scanned using like a Kinect when she was asleep, so she looks pretty good. And then the performance is all driven in real time.
That's right.
Is that her voice?
Yeah, it has a voice model in there as well.
So she's saying dad, dad.
Yeah, and if he stares at the camera and starts smiling and saying hi and paying attention, then she'll start smiling.
I'm so creeped out.
That's really creepy.
I am so creeped out.
It's
right
just
now.
The beginning. I mean, a real.
Well,
time,
I know.
Right? I call they use the word avatar to describe a virtual character, but it's a very generalized term. And I created a term years ago called a persona form, which is one that's supposed to be very, very photorealistic of an individual. And this would be a construct that you digitize yourself throughout your lifetime, and you add it to one unified database, and then you leave it behind.
When you die, you can exist.
Right. There will be a platform that will be able to run one of these constructs, and it will be able to be a virtual storytelling machine of you and your life.
We should talk, because what I'd like to do is, after I die, Twit could continue. Because, frankly, if you digitized a few hours of Twit, you got it. They got the whole thing.
That's right.
Of me going, what? No. Really? And then you just bring in hosts, other hosts, co-hosts.
So, yeah, it's some of the other animation.
She can play Pong?
Yeah, it shows the brain model working and all the various factors.
Oh, the smile is so... It is so chucky.
It's very complex.
I mean, this is like, I guess you can practice being a parent before you're actually a parent.
Right. But what the goal really would be to have... artificial intelligences that appear to us like humans.
Right.
Right.
Yeah. Well, that was.
Why not make it not human? Why not make it like a nice little round, you know, a ball or something? Because the human is what's creepy.
Yeah, until you get past a certain perception.
Until you get really good at it.
We have a lot of circuitry in our evolution in recognizing faces, and we notice when things are wrong.
Right.
And that they call that the uncanny valley.
Right.
So there's like. I was a consultant for the Casablanca Elite Modeling Agency a long time ago when they started digitizing Giselle Bundchen and
wait a minute.
Trying to be a realism consultant.
See,
you know.
I thought Giselle was fake for years.
Yeah, right.
So she's actually been an avatar
she's actually
all this
an
time.
Avatar.
Yeah, yeah.
Here's no, they, but they obviously, if you're in modeling agency, you would love to can these models.
Well, Michael Crichton wrote a movie about it called Looker back in the 70s where they digitized the models. But of course, they would kill them afterwards, so they didn't have to pay them. It was a thriller.
That's a thriller. Yeah. But, you wouldn't have to be killed; you just retire.
Yeah, well, they retired them. Bang bang.
Yeah.
In that movie.
So this is autonomous, which is what's interesting about this. This is not capture like they did with Rise of the Planet of the Apes or Gollum.
Yeah.
It's not Andy Serkis with a camera in front of his face. These are computer
Right. Generated. They actually structure the bone models and set up all the rigging in advance. And then they have a facial animation coding system, which drives the model. And then the AI drives the facial coding system. So its behavior is aligned much more with a perceptual sense of what's going on in the real world. And then the animation is driven by typical rules that normally apply to our own bone structure in our face.
Very interesting and also very creepy.
Right.
Anyway, Greg, we're going to talk more about VR because it's obviously one of the big stories that's been going on ever since Google I.O. and Cardboard. I just got my Galaxy Gear VR. I had an amazing VR experience I'll tell you a little bit about and we'll talk more about what Oculus is doing because the Rift now with all that Mark Zuckerberg money behind it, they're obviously going to make some big steps. But the big story, I think, as we convene on Sunday is tomorrow. That's when Apple's WWDC happens. And we expect many, as always, great things of Apple. The question is, what will they deliver? They've already, I think, they already sent up a little signal balloon. The New York Times reported unnamed sources said, don't count on a new Apple TV.
Yeah, that sounds like the last second they kind of pulled the plug on that thing and they wanted to manage expectations a little bit. So it leaked out that there's no TV box.
Is that
probably no TV news at all, actually.
Is that the sense that you get is that when Apple wants to do something like that, they call the Wall Street Journal or the New York Times and say, don't quote me.
Certainly feels that way, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Don't say that I said it. We want to let the world know there's not going to be an Apple TV. That's a big disappointment. Why is there not going to be an Apple TV?
Well, I've heard this. I mean, I've talked to people at Apple before who have told me they've literally pulled the plug on projects a week before they plan
it. Happens all the time.
It happens all the time. So
sometimes you'll even be watching a keynote and you'll feel like there is a chunk missing.
Right, exactly.
They just jumped.
And we might see that tomorrow because, I mean, as of 3 or 4 weeks ago, the plan was still to show this thing.
So it's not a hard... They have hardware.
They have hardware.
Well, in fact,
it's probably the software and the streaming service that we've been hearing so much about that has been hanging it up.
If you look at the WWDC invitation, that's got to be an Apple TV.
Or it's an app icon, like I said. When everyone is like, oh, it's an Apple TV. No, it looks like an app icon to me, but...
So you think that thing
icon.
In the...
Yeah, that thing in the middle.
The middle... Oh, let me close this. The middle... That's an Apple TV, that black thing?
Or an app icon. It is a developers conference, after all.
It's an Apple TV! Okay, Jill, what do you think? App icon, Apple TV in the middle there.
That's pretty square for a TV, isn't it?
No, it's the... It looks like the rounded... I should have brought my Apple TV in.
Yeah.
It looks like that. It looks just like an Apple TV.
Well, when you're saying Apple TV, are you talking about the streaming device?
Yeah, not the television set.
A television set that may...
The box,
okay,
yeah.
Because it's not that.
Nobody thinks Apple's making a television set anymore.
Well, they...
Especially not a
4.3. No. Yeah. And it would be 4.3. It would be a very bad TV.
No.
Actually, it'd be 4.4.
Yeah.
It's a square. So you're right in that. No, I'm talking about the streaming box, right? And one of the reasons we're pretty sure that that's going to be soon is that the Apple's been rolling out these HomeKit things, new devices. They need a hub. They need an interconnected hub that is also connected to the internet so that you can control it from work.
Right.
And they don't have that yet. They have the phone. They have the bits and pieces. We just saw, the light company, Lutech.
There's some light switches and things like that.
The caseta from Lutron, the caseta. But that, so that you have the way that works, according to people have had it, already have it. I think Serenity Caldwell had one. She demonstrated for us on MacBreak Weekly on Tuesday. She named her lamp Space Shuttle. And she could say, hey, Siri, turn on the Space Shuttle. And the lamp came on. And that was connected to a Lutron power plug, or maybe it was a Lutron light. And to set it up, she had the Lutron app on her iPhone, but she could use HomeKit eventually. The idea would be, I guess, HomeKit would control everything. But you still need something that is internet connected in the house that also talks to everything.
Right, and it's going to work with the current gen Apple TV. There's already I know, sir. There's already documentation out there on Apple's developer pages for HomeKit that say it'll work with the Apple TV 3 and higher.
So you don't need to go out and get a new Apple TV.
If you have the most recent Apple TV, you're fine.
So that was, okay, so that blows me out of the water because I thought, well, they have to, if they're announcing all this HomeKit stuff, as I'm sure they will tomorrow, they've got to have an Apple TV to control
right.
it. But you don't think they need an Apple TV 4. They can use the Apple TV 3.
Correct, yeah.
So it really is about the new offerings on an Apple TV that they've stalled.
Yeah, it's going to be, I mean, the big stall seems to be that over-the-top streaming service. That's kind of like Sling TV and right. this other one, PlayStation View and so forth, seems to be holding it back.
Rumors were they were actually talking to local stations.
Right.
So that if you're in Chicago, you'd get the WGN, you'd get the local stations. And then also to networks. NBC said we're not going to do it, but CBS and ABC said they would.
Yeah, Les Moonves got on stage at the Code Conference 2 weeks ago or whatever.
He said they would.
And he said he was public about, we're talking to Apple about this yeah. thing. I'm sure he violated some NDAs doing that, but he doesn't care.
It's funny because Apple just must be struggling with, because similarly, a Sony Music CEO just yesterday confirmed that Apple's going to launch a music streaming service. This must be so hard for them.
Well, it just shows you who has the leverage here, the content owners and the content creators. Apple doesn't have
the
leverage.
They don't have to shut
up. They can be quiet about it, but right. these guys have all the leverage in these negotiations. They own all the streaming content that we're going to want to consume through this Apple service. So yeah. they can say whatever they want. But Apple can't complain.
Doug Morris is the CEO of Sony Music. He was speaking in Cannes at the Mydom Music Industry Festival. And he said, Apple will announce its new music streaming service tomorrow at WWDC. It's happening tomorrow, Morris said. all right. Well, there you go. What does Apple bring to this, Morris said? Well, they've got $178 billion in the bank, and they have 800 million credit cards and iTunes. Spotify has never really advertised because it's never been profitable. My guess is Apple will promote this like crazy, and I think that will have a halo effect on the streaming business. He's very bullish. A rising tide will lift all boats. Yeah, I find that music executives like to...
Well, like he has those. To be bullish on it, doesn't he?
Yeah.
No one's buying CDs.
Right.
Digital music sales are flat. They need a streaming service that
he
goes
says
mainstream.
It's not just going to help Apple. It's just the tipping point for all streaming services.
Right.
Spotify's the dominant service at this point. Jill, you obviously, you're a runner. You talk about the exercise bands. You must listen to, you listen to music while you run?
No, I listen to podcasts, believe
Smart
it or not.
Smart woman. There you go. I like you even more.
Yeah, no, but I know Spotify has a new feature now called Spotify Running. I think it's for premium members only, and you can turn on a streaming music that will match the beat of your cadence as you're running. So I've seen a couple other apps that do the same thing, but now Spotify is going to try to do it too. And I would actually argue with you that Spotify is one of the big leaders, but Pandora is very often overlooked
still in
the U.S. in particular. They're a very strong company. I talked to some of the executives there not too long ago, and they have quietly had a huge chunk of the streaming music, you know, pocketbook for a long time. They have very dedicated, loyal users. They do a good job with their advertising. So I think it's still a very competitive space, and it kind of speaks to Apple's strength in that it likes to look at markets, see what's working, see what's not working, and take its time before it rolls out a product. So I think Apple's kind of primed right now to roll out some streaming music, but let's not forget that that landscape is actually pretty competitive right now.
Yeah, it's very competitive. I have to confess I have a little bit of a dog in the hunt because Spotify, when they announced podcasts, we were one of the partners.
You guys are all over it. I noticed that.
Yeah. I was very happy to see Daniel Ek standing next to our logo. But we're excited because that's 60 million people who can listen or watch because Spotify added video, which I thought was very interesting. Turns out video on mobile is huge that I would never have thought, and certainly I never watch. Well, maybe in bed, I might watch a little YouTube or something because it's tied to an article. But I would generally prefer not to watch video on it.
It's kids.
It's kids.
They're stinking
kids
millennials.
Today. Well, we're not going to benefit from that.
At least they can see without glasses.
Yeah, exactly. But you know, you can. But that's why I like the Gear VR.
I can just glue it
to my forehead, and I can see everything. So yeah, but doesn't the music industry hate Pandora, Jill? I mean, they would love to put Tim Westergren and company out of business.
I think the music industry needs to figure out that it needs to love Pandora and Spotify and Apple. Like, the music industry isn't its own thing anymore. It really needs to work with other partners to be successful. The people who I think are still grumpiest are the artists themselves. So that's a place where Apple might actually have some innovation. If they can make, you know, if they can make Bono from U2 super happy, maybe they can have good relationships with other artists and make them happy, because they're the ones who are still complaining. They're not getting a good, decent chunk of money from these streaming services the way that they did when CD sales were higher, when they would have bigger margins on their concert touring, things like that.
I feel like it's somebody's getting money. I mean, Tim always says we pay billions of dollars to the music industry every year. Somebody's getting money. And if an artist is not getting it, well, it sounds like the label's just keeping it.
The record company gets it. Yep.
They're just keeping it. Don't get mad at the streaming music services. Get mad at your label. Make a better deal next time around.
And right? It's only the superstars, the Taylor Swifts, the Drakes, you know, all the Beyoncés who have that leverage with the labels. But the little guys don't.
And they're saying, and I understand and I believe it, you could pay it a million times and I get 50 cents. It's not
right.
It's not going to make me rich. It is. You didn't get much. Oh, we're losing you. We're going to replug your headset in there, Jill.
She's turned into a robot.
Yeah. She's a robot. She's turning into one of the Greg Panos' creations.
Yeah, Jill, unplug and replug your headset.
Very, very greedy. I grew up in New York back in the 80s, and I knew a lot of big, big record executives and people in the music industry. So I used to go to Studio 54 all the time and hang out with them. And they were so greedy. There was so much money rolling in all the time. They were not ready for the future. When the future happened... Right. They immediately took a financial hit. And so rather than study and learn and adopt and adapt, they wanted to throw a steamroller over everything and get in the way. And so, you know, to this day, that sort of lack of compliance with the movement towards the future has been bad for them.
And it's in their
they're
DNA.
Still behaving, still behaving badly like spoiled children. That
Cory Doctorow always said.
They'll never go back to the day of the $17
It's not going to happen.
That gets scratched and you go buy another one. I mean, I remember when CDs were just happening. Everyone was so upset and so livid that the potential for copying them could actually take place or that they sounded better or they would last longer.
Right. Cory Doctorow always said the whole point of view of the current music executives is, look, I know this is going to happen. I just don't want to happen on my watch. I'm going to hold the fort until I retire and then some kid can suffer the consequences. Well, guess what? Here we are. It's almost 20 years into the digital revolution. I first heard about MP3s in 1994.
Right. Right.
I think it's time to kind of figure it out.
It was that famous line from the movie about Facebook that Justin Timberlake said. He said, have you been into a Tower Records lately?
Yeah, right. Can you find a Tower Records?
Yeah.
You know, the Tower Records in San Francisco used to be the greatest record store in the world.
Right.
It's a dry cleaner.
Yeah.
It's a dry cleaner now.
I saw three of them being opened last time I was in Tokyo. In
Tokyo, they're opening record stores, apparently, says Chris. Jill, is Jill better? Is Jill all better? Yeah. All right. Sorry about that, Jill.
My problem.
No, it's some magic thing. We know that there's a chip that has a problem. And
Ritual frog.
Yeah. Mm. You plug it in.
That happened to me when I was on a few weeks ago.
Yeah, it's weird, isn't it? Yeah. I'm sorry, what were you saying? Do you remember?
I was just saying that Taylor Swift, that I think Greg pointed out, she actually was one of the people who pulled from Spotify because she said, right, this is not worth it for me.
Yeah, but you know what? If you're Taylor Swift, you can do that. 1989 sold very well. People actually bought the album.
Yeah.
But that's Taylor Swift. I have to think that other artists who want to be discovered need to embrace streaming music. I mean, how... We've had this debate before.
If it can't work for Taylor Swift financially, how is it going to work for anybody else financially?
That's true. But what if, okay, so you're an unknown band, and you just made your first album. What do you do? You can't depend on the record company to push it on the radio stations. Who even listens to radio anymore?
YouTube, Spotify. Spotify would love to be your record label.
Yeah.
They would love that. And you can... If you do get big on there, you would get a bigger slice of.
What about Jay-Z's title? Because that's the pitch Jay-Z's making to his buddies.
Well, that's that it's exclusive and, you know, higher quality.
You're
going to
get
so
the
forth.
First release yeah. of the new album here.
You can see Nicki Minaj and Beyonce's new video before anyone else. Right. It's $15 a month. It's going to fail.
It's going to fail.
Oh, yeah.
It's not going to happen.
It doesn't have a prayer.
Apple, unfortunately, won't be able to come in under $10. They had hoped, I think, to get it cheaper.
And no free tier either.
No free.
Yeah.
But that's their pitch, isn't it? Apple's been saying to the... Look, Apple's got to do something to say, we're better than Spotify, Tidal, Pandora. So how do they do that? They say no free, right? And we'll give you more.
You know what? I wouldn't be surprised if come September, when new devices are actually rolling out, some people who buy new devices get, say, a month free. Because Apple has done that kind of thing before, right? So they'll roll out a new version of their Office suite, and they'll say everybody who buys the newest version gets it for free. Right. Everybody else has got to pay for it.
Free forever? No, just free for a
month
while.
Or something.
Yeah,
for a month. Yeah, but I think there will be some way for people to try it out before they have to shell out some money.
Oh well, I mean that's how all of these guys work. You can get a free month on any of the services right now. Just sign up. I wonder if Apple might. And by the way, this is their repurposed version of Beats, right?
Yeah.
We don't know how much repurposed. We don't know if it'll have many of the Beats. You know, Beats has some nice features. You build a sentence. You know, I want to dance at Studio 54 with Weezer wearing, I don't know, glitter shorts. I don't know. I can't remember what the sentences are.
Roller arena.
And then you get music that would presumably match that crazy sentence. Because they got to roll out on Android as well as iOS, right?
It sounds like they're going to do that too.
You would not want to roll out on Android. That'd leave out half the universe.
It's going to be like bringing iTunes to Windows for the first time. Yeah.
Which was controversial at Apple. It's going to be $10. I wouldn't be surprised to see them announce it tomorrow and say it's launching in a week or maybe even tomorrow. We don't know. And although apparently they're still making deals up to the last minute, so it may not be ready to go. And 3 months. I'm gonna trump you, Jill. 3 months free. How about that? 90 days free. How about if you buy an iPhone a year free? And Apple would have to subsidize that, right?
But I think what's more important, think of this. iPhone 6S or 7 or whatever it is comes out this fall. 50 million people buy them at the Christmas quarter. That's 50 million people who will log on to the iOS for the first time.
Right.
Setting up their new phone on Christmas morning and imagine getting a pop-up saying, hey, try Apple Music, and if you like it, after a month, we'll just charge the iTunes credit card that we already have. Right. That could be huge.
By the way, Pandora has 79.2 million monthly active listeners. Spotify, 60. So you're right, Jill. Pandora is the king of the hill on this one. I have both.
I don't pay for Pandora. I use the free tier. Yeah. But I don't use it that much either. I pay for Spotify and I love it.
Spotify's great.
Yeah.
That's the one thing. Aren't these kind of sticky? We've talked about this before. I mean, if you create playlists on Spotify, you can't move them over to Apple's service. So aren't they somewhat sticky? It's not something like you go, oh, well, I'm going to have a free Apple service, so maybe I'll just cancel my Spotify. You're not going to.
No, you'll lose a lot.
Well, I think there's two things that Pandora and Beats do that are similar. The Pandora was the one who pioneered the whole music genome project.
Right.
So this was where they hired people to say, if you like song A, then you will probably like song B. And here's song C by some artist you've never heard of before. But it was people behind those algorithms. It wasn't just numbers figuring out what you might like based on algorithms. It was actually people making those suggestions. And if I'm not mistaken, Beats does something similar to that. And that was part of why Apple was interested in them, was this sort of like personal curation, personal selection of music. So I think that's probably going to be something that, if it works well, could be to their advantage. And it doesn't necessarily mean that you're going to bring your playlist library with you, because you're going to use this service to get recommendations for new music.
Here's what Bloomberg Business is reporting. Apple's new music app will be home to the subscription service, downloads, and a revamped version of iTunes Radio. Downloads is interesting because that implies that the iTunes store will be somehow connected to this.
Yeah, it might
just
be the music
app. You'll listen to a song and say, buy it and download it. Now I own it. Although I have to say, when you have Spotify, why buy music?
Right. I haven't bought music in forever.
You want to hear the new Mumford & Sons album? You just listen.
Exactly.
Record industry executives weep when they hear
I know,
talk
and that's
like
but
that.
That's the problem, isn't it?
They weep all the way to the bank.
Well, maybe, I don't know.
I think what's happening is the future is definitely human-curated tagging and relational databases that do predictive modeling. So there are people that are sitting there listening to the music and tagging it,
right.
And those tags go into a database that
right.
hashes through all the stuff it knows about you, and then it comes up with predictive models over a high probability, low probability of like it. And then if you feed it any additional information,
thumbs up, thumbs
it refines
down.
The model yeah. for you.
I don't feel like Pandora does that great a job.
They yeah. pioneered it, though, pretty much.
Yeah. Right.
But don't you find Pandora repetitive and...
So is Spotify, so is iTunes Radio.
I guess so.
Yeah.
It has to be repetitive, otherwise it's you can't monetize it. It's just like that one penny can't be divided into too many parts.
So that's it's intentional.
Yeah.
Yeah. yeah.
Oh.
Because someone has to be making money somewhere in the chain.
Let's keep playing that song.
It's like radio.
Well, it's not that radio's not repetitive.
Consultants
my God.
Come into radio and they dictate a playlist, and that's what you hear over
Top
and over.
Top 40
and over.
Radio wasn't even 40. There were 10 songs, maybe.
Right. Yeah.
Apparently, according to this story in Bloomberg Businessweek, artists often welcome videographers and photographers into the studio with them to record behind-the-scenes video. Apple has hired executives to help shoot and produce video from recording sessions with willing musicians, so there would be differentiator.
Yeah, right? That would be like getting an album and opening
extras,
up the art
right.
and looking at the lyrics. That might be the digital equivalent of that, I guess.
The app will feature artist pages, mostly seen as being promotional. They can use to host videos, songs, and other things for free. This is part of a program Apple's going to call Apple Connect. Apple will compensate the artists and labels for songs it gives away. So, and there's a precedent for this. They do that free song of the week. They pay for that.
Yeah.
That comes out of Apple's pocket. Apple's negotiations with the record labels, Bloomberg goes on to say, have drawn the scrutiny of U.S. antitrust officials. The FTC is looking at whether Apple's using its position as the largest seller of music downloads. It's the largest seller of music, period. Forget downloads. There's no Tower Record anymore, kids. To put rival music services at a disadvantage. So that's another problem Apple might face. You can't be too successful.
As if the FTC really cares about them.
Maybe they don't think they care.
They're sitting at their desk being paid, they have something to do.
Got to do something.
Right.
We're talking about the week's news. We're talking about what's going to happen at WWDC. There's more of that, of course. We're not even close to scratching the surface of what Apple might say tomorrow. Greg Panos is here, an expert in virtual reality. His website is the Persona Foundation. That's where you're talking about all this stuff. You're talking about these what do you call them, avatars?
Well, but that's more of my simulation, a human simulation.
Human simulation.
It's a portal where I source and...
Look, we got to do this. I want you to kind of make... We got to figure out a way. Like next time Jill's here, she should be sitting here.
Yeah.
With us.
Yeah.
Even though if I put my hand, it would go right through her.
There's a way to do that.
That's what I think. Yeah.
They're doing that
Jessica Yellen did it on CNN.
Right.
At great expense.
The holography. I just spoke at the Hologram USA company in Beverly Hills a couple of weeks ago.
So we could have holographic guests?
Yeah, sure.
There's
a lot
expensive
of different,
would that be
lot
like
of,
Star
well,
Wars?
I mean, if you're going to use the Hologram USA's tech, it's expensive.
Yeah, because we'd have to put cameras where Jill is sitting. She'd be surrounded by a ring of cameras, right?
Well, there's different ways to do it. You bring different kinds of reflective screens, it peppers ghost effects, multiple projectors from different points of view.
I love
it's,
Pepper's Ghost.
It's really
ghost
a
effect.
Wide open
That's an old
field
magic
for
trick.
Experimentation. Yeah,
Pepper's
it is.
Ghost. Was it mirrors? How did they do that?
Well, it's a mirror on a close to 45-degree angle that's semi-transparent. And so it was a projector at the top aiming down to the mirror and then...
It's like how a DSLR works.
Right. And it's like, half open,
half
shutter.
Open.
Right?
Yeah, there you go.
And then you can walk around on the stage behind it and also be registered with the projections. So someone looking from the front sees you both at equal brightness.
There's two of you.
Right.
Ooh.
So that was a really good meeting, down in
I just want to not have
Hills.
To come to work.
Yeah. Well, Ray Kurzweil has spoken virtually at conferences.
Has he?
It's called a tele-lectern or hollow.
I saw that
lectern.
On the Silicon Valley. That didn't work so well. Hooli had one of those. Remember that?
They right, were, yeah.
Let's take a break. Also, Jill Duffy here for PC Magazine and... from Business Insider's SAI, Steve Kovach. It's great to have all three of you, and great to have you viewing the show. Thank you for joining us this week. If my doorbell rings, I apologize. If you hear this in the middle of the show, actually, this will be my phone ringing. I'm using, I love this thing. I just installed this a few weeks ago, the Ring Video Doorbell. So here's the idea. With Ring, you can see and talk to anyone at your door, no matter where you are, using your smartphone. My doorbell rings, even if I'm sitting here. I could press a button, say, hey, what is it? It's very clear, by the way. The sound's clear. You can see them, hear them. I could say, leave the package and go. Or whatever, you know. Get out, go out, get off my lawn, I can say. They also have motion sensors in there. So I have on my smartphone, every time somebody's moved in front of my door, I have a little video of them. It is so cool. They don't even have to ring your doorbell. See, it turns out that 95% of home break-ins happen during the day. And almost always, the burglar rings your doorbell first to see if you're home and then comes in if you're not. But see, this time you can respond. And you'll have a perfect, clear picture of your burglar. That's my, there's my front steps, stoops right there. See that car going by?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. What's he doing? He's casing the joint.
Does that have a dog barking function?
Yeah, you should have
a
dog.
I can do it. through the phone.
Could record Ozzy and slow it down.
I installed it myself. Look, I'm not a handyman, and I will never play one. But this thing makes it so easy. If you look at the Ring kit.
Is it battery powered? Or? Yeah,
there's two ways to go. If you have a, we have a wired doorbell, so I just use the existing wires. It replaced the existing doorbells. My doorbell still rings in the house, just like normal. Mm-hmm. But then it's also is battery powered. It has lithium ion batteries. In fact, it comes with a USB cable. It comes with everything. And you can charge it and lasts about a year because it doesn't use much juice. It comes with a level, a spirit level, a screwdriver handle, the bits you need, including the proprietary bit that keeps people from stealing it. There's got a special screw in there. Great wide-angle camera, and the doorbell. Time magazine named it one of the top gadgets, the top 10 gadgets of last year. I have actually tried, believe it or not, other video doorbells. This one is easy. It uses Wi-Fi to connect it to the rest of the world. Now, we got a deal for you, too. Normally $200, $25 off right now. If you go to ring.com/twit, that's $174. Everything you need to install it. I'm no handyman. It took me about, I think if I knew what I was doing, it took me about half an hour. It took me an hour because I was reading the manuals. They actually have great videos that show you how to do it. I was watching all of that. And now, if anybody's at my door, I can see it. By the way, if you get a month of recording free, it's $30 a year to store all the motion recordings from people at your doorbell. So you see, these are motion. And then if somebody rings the doorbell, I'm going back in time now, it'll say missed, or if you answered, it'll say answered. This is my doorbell. I can see when people come and go. It's so awesome. Ring.com/twit, save $25. Oh, there's Lisa going off in the Segway. She's leaving.
Was that now or earlier?
That was earlier.
Okay.
Because it's a recording. I paid the. You get the month free of recording. Isn't that cool?
Wheels for legs.
Yeah. I love my Segways.
So how does this doorbell respond to search warrants?
Go away. I'm not here. I'm in the bathtub. That's a good question. Actually, I'll have to try that next time I get a search warrant. You can't come in. It actually works really well, and they can't tell you're not there. I mean, it sounds like you're there. It's like an intercom, except I'm not. I'm here.
He calls the police and tells them that there's a break-in. And the FBI agent gets dragged off in handcuffs.
I love it. That's a good idea. I'll have to try that. Ring.com/
I think you'd only get away with it once.
Twit. Yeah, once and only once. We're talking about WWDC. Of course, that's tomorrow. We will do live coverage, as we always do, of the keynote. Mike Elgin, Andy Anatko, and I think Georgia Dow from iMore will also be joining us in studio. We expect it'll begin 10 a.m. Pacific, 1 p.m. Eastern time, 1700 UTC Monday. That's June, what is that, June 9th? Tomorrow. 8th. Are you going to be in the event?
Yeah, I'll be there.
Yeah?
I'll be on the floor. I have to get there at 8 a.m.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow. It's at Moscone. Is it at the
Moscone West?
It's Moscone West. That's the big one.
Yeah.
Interesting. I guess they're gonna have a lot of developers there. Do they still throw you out after the keynote? That's what they used to do at WWDC.
From what I understand, this year there's a media lounge to kind of chill out and file your stories, and then
so they'll say go out the front door. They say go over there to the lounge, sit.
Yeah.
Sit, relax.
And then lure the developers you out go with to a gift sessions, bag.
Of course. Here's your gift bag.
Yeah.
See ya. I don't think we're hearing any big hardware announcements, especially since we're now pretty sure we're not going to hear an Apple TV. They'll talk about software, though.
Right.
An Apple Watch SDK.
That's big.
Well, it is big because it'll allow people to write apps for the watch.
Natively, yeah.
Right now, you have to install the app on your phone, and then it puts a little stub on your watch.
Yeah, it's garbage.
It's terrible.
It's so bad.
They've got to speed up the launch time, too, because you try to launch something, and you're waiting for... By the time it's done, you could have gotten the phone out, done what you wanted to do, yep. Like Uber. Oh, I'm going to call an Uber my watch. Isn't that cool? No, it's not. You're sitting there spinning. You get the phone out, call the Uber, put it back. It's still spinning. Right?
Yeah. It's cool when it works, and sometimes it will be a little faster, and then right. It feels like magical. But most of the time, you see that little spinning icon.
Yeah, it's a great demo.
Yeah.
I feel like a lot of what's on the... I have a watch, too. You notice I'm not wearing it. Mm-hmm. I see you're wearing Sport.
I got the Sport one.
It's very pretty.
Yeah, it's nice.
You can make a commercial where you call the Uber and it picks a guy up that's 10 feet away from you first, and then you wait another hour.
No, that's no commercial at all.
It took too long. 10 seconds too long.
I feel like, increasingly feel like the Apple Watch is not delivering what it promised.
I enjoy using it, but it's weird because I get more out of it when I strip out a lot of the features. Like the apps.
Maybe that's the key.
Yeah.
You don't want too many notifications.
Right.
You want fewer glances.
Mm-hmm.
I find I spend a ton of time twiddling, tweaking, pushing, zooming, and it's not...
People try to use it like a mini smartphone on your wrist, and I don't think you should use it that way.
It's not a good interface.
Yeah.
Jill, did you were the one who introduced me to the Basis watch. You've used every one of these, and you particularly focus on the fitness aspects. What do you think of the fitness aspects on the Apple Watch?
You know, I haven't played with it so much, but my real question to people about what you and Greg were just talking about is, what were your original expectations for the Apple Watch? Because I feel like that's really where the disconnect is, that people don't necessarily have a clear idea in their head what they want it to do.
Right.
They just think it's going to be some magical extension of their smartphone, but they're not really having a realistic expectation of the kinds of notifications it's going to deliver, how it's going to deliver those, and how often you're going to be looking at it. So I'm actually curious to ask both you and Greg Leo.
Actually, Steve, who has
Steve. I have the watch.
Oh, sorry,
Greg
Steve.
Does have it. Yeah.
Sorry. What you thought it was going to do or what you wanted it to do. What were your expectations?
What did you hope for, Steve?
Well, that's the thing. I don't think Apple did a good job explaining what this thing is supposed to do. You know, we got the iPhone. They did a really good explanation of, you know, smartphones have stunk for years. Now we made it better. But we get the Apple Watch, and here's all the stuff it can do, but no, like, why do you need this thing?
I almost feel like Apple had hoped it would do more.
Yeah.
And was disappointed that it couldn't do as much as they wanted it to do.
Right.
And they even threw in stuff because it wasn't going to do whatever, blood pressure monitoring. So they threw in the heartbeat, not the heart rate sensor, the sending a heartbeat to somebody and drawing little pictures because they just needed something. They needed to give it some special sauce. Here, I'll tell you what my expectation was, and it's absolutely been dashed. Apple has in the past taken existing categories like MP3 players and shown the way with the iPod. Like, this is how you do it. With smartphones, they showed the way with the iPhone. There were smartphones before the iPhone, but the iPhone reinvented the category. iPad reinvented the tablet. I really hoped, I actually didn't expect, but I hope, because I've used, as you have, Jill, you know, I bought the Basis because you said to buy it. I've been using Android Wear. I've used every smartwatch, all the Samsung smartwatches. And I knew that they were, much like the early days of MP3 players and smartphones and tablets, not there. And I'd hoped that Apple would reinvent the category and point the way to something better. And in fact, I feel like they did the opposite. I think they tried to do too much. I think the user interface is god-awful.
It takes a day to learn it, to get used to, at least a day.
Learn it, it's terrible. I mean, the little dot icons that you zoom in and out, that's useless.
That's why I never go to the app screen, except to maybe set a timer or something. I almost never look at the apps. I find it most useful as a watch, quickly glance at it when it vibrates.
So you're saying if you lower your expectations, Leo, you'll be happy.
Yeah, exactly. Well, that's the thing. Like any Apple product that comes out, the expectations are through the roof. Are they going to redefine this category and so forth?
People are saying in the chat room, and they're right, the iPhone itself, when it first came out, wasn't all it was going to be. But there was no question when you play with an iPhone, this is a breakthrough product.
Oh, yeah.
You know, multi-touch. By itself, multi-touch was a breakthrough. The fact that you could use a browser on the phone and actually have an experience of a website that was much like the desktop experience, that was a breakthrough. But that's not what we're seeing, I don't think, with the Apple Watch. Jill, you don't have one, Jill, I take it.
No, I don't have one. Yeah. I just borrow. But one of the things I often hear people saying is that we have to remember a lot of people who write about technology are on the East Coast and the West Coast.
Right.
Specifically San Francisco and New York,
yep.
Where we don't have a lot of cars. And oh. I often hear from people who want smartwatches, they say, I want it because when I'm in my car and I got an important message, I want to be able to glance at something, maybe like hit a button and reply back, hey, I'm driving, let me know if it's important. But I think there are certain use cases like being in a car that sometimes people in San Francisco and New York don't connect with very well.
I drive a car every day,
I got to tell you,
if you did that, you would crash. It is as difficult, if not more difficult, to use your watch as using a smartphone. You shouldn't do either while you're driving.
Of course not.
Because the watch is distracting and you need both hands because one hand is holding it, the other one's twiddling the little knob, and all of a sudden you're in an accident.
So I want to tie this in with one more thing, which is Google Glass, which we all know failed as a consumer product. I still think it actually has a lot of wonderful uses in the world of industry, like if you're on an oil rig, for example. But in consumer life, we decided this is not something we want. But if you think about it, it was going to do very similar things that the Apple Watch and other smartwatch promised, right? It was going to be something that would give you a quick glance that wouldn't distract you so much, give you information that was pertinent, give you information that was relevant to your context, and that you could go along with your day. And everybody decided, no, this is not what we want at all. It's ugly, it's another device,
right.
It has to be recharged every night. And I think it's important to remember that there are sociological instances for when we do and do not want to use certain devices. And I think we've grown accustomed to having our smartphone and being dependent on it as sort of our primary device in a lot of ways. And I don't think we're going to break away from that too easily with a peripheral device like a watch or a pair of glasses.
I think you're right. Steve's Apple Watch review came out in Business Insider in May. You'd had it for a week or two.
I used it for a week before I read that review. Yeah.
Would you stand by what you said? Do you think
totally?
Yeah.
I use it mostly
it's
as
a watch.
And I gave it to my boss and he freaked out saying like, I can't do anything on it. My phone already does all the same stuff. And I really think people are looking at it the wrong way.
We're just asking too much.
Yeah. I've become addicted to mine. I tested the Pebble also, the new Pebble Time, and I took it off for a few hours to let one of my video producers shoot a video with it. And I felt naked without a watch.
They say that's one of the tests.
Yeah.
If you left the house without it, would you go back and get it?
Yeah, I totally would.
You would?
Yeah, I found myself and went to lunch and I was looking at my naked wrist like several times, looking for the time, the weather, if I had a text.
And as you pointed out, you are not a watch wearer. You hadn't worn a watch.
No, I haven't worn a watch since 04 maybe.
Yeah, I like watches as jewelry. I don't feel like we need them to tell the time because really we got lots of time all around us. I like clocks though. I mean, we have clocks everywhere in the studio.
I like the episode of Will It Blend where they tested the Apple Watch.
Yeah.
That hurts every time I see them do that. It just hurts me. It's like, why destroy it? Oh, perfectly good watch.
Blend's fine. Just don't breathe it once you open the blender.
Right.
Right. That's probably true. I don't know what that's made out of. Human tears. I feel like the watch, if you haven't bought the watch, don't feel like you need to buy the watch. The reason this came up is Apple was probably going to show how people can write apps for the watch.
Yeah.
Will they run faster?
Ideally, yes.
I hope so, because they don't run fast enough
fitness
now.
Fitness apps will be able to take advantage of all the sensors.
They'll be able to do more.
So Fitbit and Jawbone and whoever else can write an Apple Watch app, and you don't have to buy a Fitbit.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. Apple just bought
he's blending in.
Geez.
At least it's the sport model.
Yeah, there's $400 on
there.
Apple just bought an AR company called Mataya.
Yeah.
So they have some pretty interesting applications that fill in information about what you're doing. So I could see having a watch and sort of like moving it around and having it give alerts and stuff as you're moving into a particular direction of Chinese food or something like that.
Chinese food that way.
Right. Yeah.
It's like wetting your finger and sticking it in the... Instead, you go like this.
Right. Yeah. It's this whole symbology of what's going on around you in space-time.
Right.
Very simple visual symbology, circles and squares and arrows and pointers popping up and popping down depending on its position and the sensors knowing where it is.
Well, so apps could make a big difference in that regard because
oh, yeah.
You can't even do app animation on the Apple Watch today.
Not
you can
really.
Only put pictures up.
The real problem is so many developers are trying to cram a smartphone app into
right.
this little tiny screen. And it doesn't, like Instagram.
Marco Arment observed that.
Yeah,
he said,
did it wrong the first time,
I did
too.
It wrong yeah. the first time, yeah.
And, you know, I don't want to squint at news headlines and right. Instagram photos and tweets on my wrist. No, that doesn't make any sense. It should be very quick in and out. And if you want to do anything beyond glancing at your wrist, you go to the phone.
But that's going to disappoint people because they wanted to do a whole lot more.
Yeah, and that's also Apple's fault to a degree not putting it into good context, what this thing is supposed to do.
We will see a new iOS. This is one thing Apple's done pretty well. Every year there's a new iPhone, and every year there's a new iOS, iOS 9, codenamed Monarch, not after the butterfly, after a ski resort. And, of course, this is a developers conference, so that's really what people who come to WWDC want to hear about. What's the next generation of... In fact, you know, we have some interest. We're starting to work, or we're thinking of, we're planning to start to plan to work on a, we're going to consider planning to start to work on a plan that would give us an app. But that's one of the things we have to think about is, well, wait a minute, should we start working on apps today when Android M and iOS 9 are imminent? Should we wait? But the consensus seems to be iOS 9 won't be as grotesque, huge differences between, say, 6 and 7.
And it'll be 2 years before people have Android M anyway, so.
M is nothing to worry about, yeah. iOS 9 and, in fact, OS 10, 10.11, codenamed Gala, Apple has kind of sent signals that we're not going to be big new features, we're going to make them a little bit better, smarter, faster, and so forth.
Gala means milk in Greek.
Oh. I think they're probably named after the apple,
like
the Gala apple.
Galaxy. Oh, yeah, Gala
I think
apple.
It's more likely. Yeah. Oh, but it is a little bit like Galaxy, isn't it? I didn't think of that.
Yeah.
Copying Samsung.
Yes.
The Milky Way.
I think the biggest thing about iOS 9 is they're kind of rewriting it for the older Apple devices. You know, Apple always gets dinged for, you know, you update iOS and it slows down your phone. It sounds like it's going to be better on older devices, which is great for... emerging markets where people are using iPhone 4S's and whatevers.
That's a big change from Apple. Usually Apple really wants to push you to the new thing. I had somebody call the radio show today who had an iPad 2, and he says, it's getting slower and slower. I said, actually, it's not. It's just iOS is getting more and more demanding. But this would be a big improvement if he could continue to use his iPad 2. I think that's a good idea. Now, there will be some changes to the desktop interface regarding security. They're going to introduce this new rootless... state for OS 10 that will prevent even administrative level users from accessing protected system files. It also, rootless is handy because it prevents jailbreaking.
Right.
On iOS. Whoops.
Do you even need a jailbreak anymore? Is there even a jailbreak community left?
Is there a jailbreak anymore?
I don't know. I feel like we never hear about it anymore.
Yeah. I'm sure people are still doing it. By the way, I'm sorry. I said rootless was for OS 10. It is for iOS. iCloud Drive, boy, they need to fix that. That thing, I don't know what's going on with it. It's confusing, and it's difficult, and it's done. None of my Macs does it work. Trusted Wi-Fi is in development. That could be part of this year's iOS or maybe next year. It would allow iOS devices to connect to authorized wireless routers without additional security measures. But would require a more... heavily encrypted wireless connection for non-trusted routers. This is all from Mark Gurman at 9to5, and he's usually pretty good. His sources are excellent.
He's pretty solid. He knows his stuff.
Split-screen apps for iPad.
That'll be interesting.
I feel like that's the wrong direction. It's like a concession a little bit to get to Samsung's dual windows.
And Surface a little bit.
And Surface. I try to use... on my Note 4, I tried to use split-screen. It's too small a screen. I guess on Surface it makes a little bit of sense.
On Surface.
Yeah. Do you think Apple's really losing sales to iPad sales to Microsoft?
No, I think people are hanging on to their iPads longer.
That's the problem.
You change your phone every year, maybe usually every 2 years, but you can hang on to the iPad for 3, 4, maybe even 5 years if we push it. So this is an interesting way that split screen will probably set it up to when they have the jumbo-sized iPad later this year.
both Android and Microsoft have for a long time off, not for a long time, Microsoft has for a long time, Android just started offering multi-user mode where you could have, in Lollipop, you could have multiple users, which for a tablet makes a lot of sense. Apple's never allowed that, but there is a rumor that there will. I would love to see this iPad Pro. I hope. I don't know if they'll announce this tomorrow.
No, it's not going to be the fall with the typically when they announce their iPads.
Apple Pay expand to the United Kingdom and Canada, but HomeKit's going to be big. HomeKit's going to be a big announcement, and we mentioned that the Apple TV is going to be the gateway device for HomeKit, and they've already announced some HomeKit devices. Mm-hmm.
As I mentioned. Even last year, a bunch of big names like Philips and household names that we know have said we're going to make stuff for this platform.
Yeah. You know, I feel like home automation is something people wanted 10 years ago. And
or
now
50
less
years
so.
Ago.
Or 15 years ago. And now we've kind of gave up.
Yeah.
Do you really, what do you think?
I think all the Snowden revelations have woken people up to the fact that
it's just a spy device.
If the government wants back doors and everything, and criminals can get into
maybe
those places, then all your stuff can be, you know, robbed by people that aren't the government, that aren't interested in protecting you, and that as long as the government isn't going to make a point of protecting you, they just want to be able to source you, and they're not going to make any promises about protecting you from other people that aren't so honest or aren't so interested in your welfare, then why invest in something that's going to put you at risk until everyone else around you says, oh, this is safe, you know? And
people
so,
see the Internet of Things as really an Internet of spy devices.
Well,
they're watching me on my Nest.
Well, now they know it could be.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so, hackers, too.
Right.
Yeah.
It's what you don't know that scares you. I mean,
maybe that's where that.
There's a refrigerator that got hacked a year or two ago, which I thought was hilarious.
Why did I keep getting more milk?
It's kind of too bad for the consumer business that, you know, they're taking a hit over privacy. But, I mean, this is stuff people should know. They should make decisions about it. If they decide not to buy products as a result of it, then
thanks, NSA.
The corporatocracy that runs America needs to rein in, you know, various controls.
Now, I'm interested in this, and we've heard rumors before about something called Proactive Assistant. This is it a Siri upgrade or a replacement?
It sounds like an addition to Siri, I guess. It kind of indexes apps, or apps can plug into it. It's kind of like Now on Tap, which Google announced 2 weeks ago.
I feel like there's a great race going on between Apple, Google, and, of course, Microsoft's Cortana for these intelligent assistants. In almost every case, they're like the Apple Watch. So they promised much and deliver little. They're frustrating to use. And I think Siri is not the best of the three.
Not at all.
Not even close.
Do you like Google Now?
I love Google.
Yeah, I do too. I use Google Now on my phone. iPhone.
On your Apple?
Yeah.
Because you have to launch the Google app to even use it.
No, it sends you notifications. It sent me a notification to come here and make it on time. And,
That's one of the reasons I use Android is I love Google Now.
It works well.
But you know what's going to, you know, here's the dark horse in this that nobody's considered. Amazon.
Alexa.
The Amazon Echo is starting to prove to be really cool.
Yeah. Do you have one?
No, I'm on a waiting list forever. But we had one for review because one of our editors was smart enough to order one when it first came out. It was $99 if you're Amazon Prime. They've raised that to $150, and they've really constrained supply. You can't even get two.
Right.
If you get an invitation, you can get one. I ordered one, and it's supposed to come late July, early August. But many of our viewers have them, and it's impressive as heck.
Sounds really cool.
You can now add to your calendar. You could say make an appointment. You can have it play. They just integrated Audible Books, so you can listen to Audible Books. You can listen to podcasts using TuneIn. You can say, Alexa. I'll call it, what should I call it? We got to be, you know, this is, by the way, another big problem. I can't say any of these words. Okay, you know who. Hey, you know who. Because everybody watching at home, all of a sudden their stuff wakes up and starts talking to them. The Amazon Echo, we could say, hey, Echo, how about that? I don't think it responds to that, is really getting very sophisticated. It has a speaker built into it, and it's not mobile. It's designed to sit in your room, but you talk to it, and it's kind of almost what I really want. It's just, I want an intelligent assistant I can talk to.
A friend.
A friend. Okay, yeah, that's the truth.
Well, you know, it might come from the Chinese. Baidu has a huge AI group now.
Oh, do they?
Yeah, that's being run by Andrew Ng out of Stanford. So they've got like 150 AI researchers, and they're all looking at the same stuff that Kurzweil's looking at Google, natural language understanding, learning, machine learning, predictive modeling. So, you know, what you're asking for and what you want it to do, you'll eventually get. Your frustration will be solved because there's many minds at work.
Working at it.
That are doing that.
Well, in fact, while Google is probably doing the foremost speech recognition stuff in the United States, China has been, in fact, China might need it more than we need.
Yeah, the problems are not specific to the English language.
Right.
They're specific to all cultures.
So you think we'd benefit by Baidu research, or would it require Chinese?
Well, I think if you can make it work in other languages and other cultures, probably the American culture would probably be a simpler subset.
You think so? Because we're simpler people. It's less complex.
The rules.
Chinese is tough.
The rules of our language are a little more
rigid, frankly.
Right. So you can plan a machine learning algorithm to navigate through those rules quickly.
Chinese is, the older a language gets, the more it gets sanded down. The edges get sanded down. So languages that haven't evolved over time, like Russian or Latin, are very rigid, rigorous, with lots of declensions and conjugations.
Yeah. But they're easy for machines to figure out.
And so that makes it easier for a machine. But Chinese doesn't even have past tense tenses.
Yeah, there's a lot of sort of cultural context.
Yeah, it's very contextual.
Go into the analytical.
Yeah, that must be. If they could get it working in Chinese, you're right. I bet they'd be a lot easier.
There's a big demand for it. Yeah. You know, people don't want to drive off the road. You know, they want to be able to find something very quickly by just speaking it out.
Right. Well, I'll be curious to see what Apple says about this new proactive.
And it might not even happen tomorrow. That's like something they're thinking about using. So it could be another year before they get that up to snuff. And even then, I'm not confident it will be, knowing them.
Siri's been a little bit of a disappointment. In fact, I almost feel like Siri, the app that they purchased, worked better than Siri, the Apple
version. I don't even remember. It's been so long.
Well, you could make restaurant reservations
with Siri.
Oh, that's
true, yeah.
You can't do it. But you could then. It's like they haven't even caught up with the app that they bought.
I use it to set my alarm, that's it.
That's it. Like, it's really, and the same thing, I use the watch to do that. You know, set a timer for 10 minutes.
Yeah, that's all I do.
That's really great when you're cooking. That's about it. Has Apple fixed the iMessage flaw yet?
Which one?
The one where you send a weird, malformed Unicode string and it crashes iMessage.
I don't remember. I think
it's not. Has there been a patch? I don't think so.
Someone in the chat room will probably tell us.
iOS, are we still at 8.1.3? Huh?
I haven't gotten it.
You know, Skype, I don't think
Skype
so.
Skype fixed it.
Skype fixed it in less than a day. Of course, that's just one application.
App,
I think Apple has to fix the whole operating system. Cortex is the problem. They have to fix it all. But why haven't they fixed it yet? It's been like 10 days.
Maybe they'll announce that tomorrow, too.
No, they will not. That's one thing you know. They will not come on stage and say, oh, yeah, we had this problem, but we fixed it. No. It's the thinnest, lightest bug we've ever solved. Let's take a break. We're talking. Jill Duffy's here for PC Magazine, Washington-based. She covers all wearables is one of her beats, health, lifestyle. It's good to have you here, Jill. Steve Kovach.
Thank you.
Thank you for being here. Steve Kovach from Business Insider. And Greg Panos, nice Greek name. That's why you know what galaxy is. Right. Galaxy is milk.
Grigori Paniotis Paniotakis.
Could you read that Greek that we had in the fairy message earlier before the show? It was Greek letters.
My grandfather had the sense to shorten it.
That was the name?
Yeah.
Say that again.
Grigori Paniotis Paniotakis.
Wow. I didn't realize that was your name. I thought you were saying, hello, how are you, my name. Wow.
Well, that's not on my birth certificate.
I thought he was swearing at you.
I didn't know what he was saying.
Well, I know just enough Greek to get my face punched.
I wanted to say, oppa.
Yeah, and to order in a restaurant.
Yeah. That flaming cheese thing.
Pasticcio. Yeah. Saganaki is the flaming cheese.
It's good. Greek food is very good.
I know. I grew up on it.
Where's the best Greek restaurant in San Francisco? Is there one?
I don't know. I just went to the San Jose Greek Festival last week.
I love those.
I stayed with Daniel Kockies, one
those
of my best
fun.
Friends.
So yeah, Dan's great.
We went down there, and I bought a whole bunch of pasticcio and baklava and galaktopoudika, or a Greek dessert. Galaktopoudika is galactic burrito. So, So it's basically looks like a burrito, and it's stuffed with like warm custard, which is the gala or the galactic or the milk portion of it. So that's the Greek dessert that is hard to find. It's delicious. Got two of those.
I'm
hungry.
I'm going in and out after this.
In and out.
Oh yeah. Us East Coasters don't get that.
That's right. Yeah. You got Steak and Shake or White Castle or what?
I mean, steak both. Yeah.
This is actually like White Castle. People don't understand the slider is a great thing.
Yeah, East Coast.
It's America's greatest invention. Our show today brought to you by Citrix GoToMeeting. You want virtual? You got it with GoToMeeting. It's the perfect way to meet with clients and coworkers from the convenience of your computer, your smartphone, your tablet. You'll share the same screen, so you're on the same page. And you'll see each other face-to-face with their HD video conferencing. It's so cool. Now that everybody has a camera on their iPad, their phone, on their computer, it's great. You can go to a meeting and you really see people. And I think biologically, we're getting more and more used to this idea that this is like a face-to-face meeting. I don't know why, but more and more we've been using GoToMeeting, and more I feel like this is good. This is better. Certainly eliminates travel. I don't have to worry about traffic or travel expenses or flying anywhere. I can meet with any of our clients or colleagues anywhere all around the world. And I feel like it's just as good, if not better. I want you to sign up for GoToMeeting today. Free, 30 days. Visit GoToMeeting.com and click the Try It Free button. And do it now. You'll see. You'll have your first meeting ready to go in minutes. It's easy to send out invitations via Outlook. They have a plugin. Or any email client. And, man, you're meeting like that. GoToMeeting.com. Try it free for 30 days. GoToMeeting from Citrix. Those guys have been supporters since day one of Twit, and I really appreciate everything they've done for us. GoToMeeting.com. 30 days free. See and be seen. Hey, if you missed anything, we had a big week this week on Twit. Let's take a look at some of the fun things that happened.
Previously on Twit.
And of course, we were treated once again to the sight at Google I.O. of a large number of people all using some sort of virtual reality.
Nerds.
This is straight out of Wall-E.
This week in Google.
Everybody focuses on the fact that it's just the viewer's cheap.
Well, but I think
the viewer's just a holder.
If the argument is that this is too expensive, then virtual reality has no place in school.
Know-how.
We're going to be showing you how to make a crazy fast home build. It's probably the easiest build we've ever done. Flash drive that will be cheaper and faster than the things you could buy in the market.
It's like face melting.
It really is.
The new screensavers.
We're going to burn stuff right now, and I'm hoping that we're not going to burn ourselves.
I think she's aiming at us!
Twit. Kid tested, mother approved.
Okay, a little tip.
Exercise.
Never give your wife a flaming torch on a string, and then stand there and wait for her to swing it at you.
That's a great video, though.
I'll do anything for my craft. Hey, we've got a big week coming up. Mike Elgin, our news director. What do we expect?
Coming up this week, Apple's Worldwide Developers Conference starts tomorrow. That's Monday, June 8th in San Francisco. Because of that, our daily news show, Tech News Today, airs 1 hour early tomorrow at 9 a.m. Pacific, noon Eastern. Join Leo, Andy Anatko, Georgia Dow, and me at 10 a.m. Pacific for live coverage of the big Apple keynote. Also, a Chinese handset maker called Xiaomi is expected to unveil two new phones Wednesday in Beijing. One of them, called the eLife E8, is expected to have a 23.7 megapixel camera on the back, capable of shooting 4K video. And on Thursday, June 11th, Facebook's Oculus VR is holding an event they're calling Step Into the Rift in San Francisco. We'll find out what that's all about. That's what's coming up this week. Back to you, Leo.
It's getting exciting in the VR world. One of the reasons we wanted Greg to be in studio with us today is because of this, your particular expertise in this. This is Google Cardboard based. Google showed off Cardboard at their I.O. It's a very inexpensive. How much was this, John?
25.
This is 25 bucks, but it's a little more solid. It's got... One of the things I don't like about Cardboard, you have to hold it to your, like a ViewMaster, you have to hold it to your head. So this has a strap. You still put your phone in here. This is actually kind of smart because the phone is a very powerful computer with a very good screen. Right. It really adds everything you need to do VR to what is basically just a holder.
Stereoscopic viewing visor.
Galaxy Samsung does the same thing with the Galaxy VR. I bought one of those for my Galaxy S6. I had an amazing experience. The other night, I had got the on Saturday, or I guess it was Friday, I got the VR in the mail. And we were having a sixth grade graduation party for Lisa's son. So we had a lot of kids, and I thought, oh, this is cool. I said, kids, you're going to think back. I remember in 2015, that crazy guy showed me these. I experienced VR for the first time. And I think that those kids, I have to say, I was very negative about VR. I have changed my tune. Mm. I feel like those kids are going to experience for the first time on Friday something that's going to be a big part of their life going forward. But I didn't get a chance to play with the Galaxy VR, so I got in bed, and I said, Lisa, I hope you don't mind, but I'm gonna just play with this a little bit. So first thing I learned, you can't lie on your back, because it knows where it's oriented. You have to sit up. And then I found a Cirque du Soleil.
Oh, I've done that one. That one's cool.
Oh, yeah. My God.
Yeah.
You're on stage with them.
Oh, you're on stage, and they're performing all the way around you, and you anywhere you look, there's something going on. I got so excited, I jumped out of bed, and I'm going, oh, and it's really like an experience of Cirque du Soleil. Now, the resolution's noticeably lower than real life. There's some suspension of disbelief that has to go on. And, obviously, you look like an idiot. But the experience was, to me, an eye-opener. I feel like, oh, I get it. I'm not that interested in VR gaming. It makes me nauseous to have moving through a game when I'm not moving.
Right.
I feel like that's not a good thing for me.
No.
But I love these VR experiences. There's a Paul McCartney concert. You can sit on stage.
I've done that one too.
And isn't that cool? And Beck also.
Beck?
Yeah.
I think that's a really good use for it. And Google, of course, announced that Apollo platform. I'm sorry, what is it called? Jump.
Right.
Platform with 16 cameras.
Mm-hmm.
And I imagine that's what they're using, and they're just putting it in the middle of.
Well, a lot of VR now is 360 video. So what it is it shoots a special image, and then your head and the sensors in your visor, whatever system it is, allows you to have a rectified image, which is a sphere in which you're looking around from the point of view of the 360 camera.
You can even look down and see kind of the base of the camera.
Right. Sometimes you can see artifacts that show the stitching between the cameras or the base
the
of the camera.
The stitching's gotten very good. This Cirque du Soleil was, as far as I could tell, perfect.
Right.
There was no distortion, no weird parallax.
Yeah, and Oculus just bought one of the major stitching companies called Kolor, K-O-L-O-R.
Yeah.
Was it either Oculus or Google,
Oh, no, Google bought Kolor.
Yeah. So what's happening, Google, Facebook, a.k.a. Oculus, and Apple are all scooping up companies.
What's Apple doing?
Filing patents.
That would be great to know.
Apple bought Matteo, which is an AR company.
Ah.
And there are probably a lot of other acquisitions we don't know about right now.
I was kind of skeptical of virtual reality. That's where you have to put on a helmet and you seal out the world.
Yeah, you're occluded from the world.
Occluded. And I was more excited when I saw Microsoft's HoloLens.
Yeah.
I thought augmented reality, where I'm seeing the world with additions. That's really the future. But I think now
still look like a dork.
You can put two stereo cameras on a VR system and have it act like an AR system so you can see around you.
You can do that with cardboard. The camera, you make the camera active.
Right.
Now, cardboard seems to be compatible with Oculus. In other words, the demos I download for Oculus seem to work on my...
That's cool.
Yeah. And vice versa.
They're all just spin-offs from stereoscopic rendering.
Right. It's two pictures.
Right. Right and left eye image and point of view changes.
So there
really
isn't anything that would make this, hardware specific, or is there? You could, I guess.
Well, I posed a good question to Palmer Luckey at CES that a lot of VR is going mobile, like the Samsung that you have. And some of these experience packages, like the Paul McCartney singing or the Beck, song, are 200, 150 megabyte download packages.
Huge. Yeah.
So if you're on T-Mobile and you've got a 6 gigabyte cap, and then all of a sudden you try a bunch of VR stuff out, you've blown your cap after just a couple of days. So there are going to be some real problems in the future. And some of these devices will have Wi-Fi and they'll have local memory where when they see a Wi-Fi hotspot that they can get on, they'll download a 900 megabyte asset package. And then the only thing that'll be streaming will be the positional information if you're in a shared metaverse or a shared reality.
Knowing
where you are and where they are, where everyone else is.
Could I buy a jump camera or make a jump camera, put it right there,
mm-hmm.
and you could watch this show as we make it, as if you're sitting in the audience?
Yeah, very easily.
You can do it in real time,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah, it's just one other stream.
Can you do the stitching in real time?
It's a warped image. The stitching takes place on in a platform that the cameras are connected to.
So it has to be a pretty heavy-duty processor.
It can work in real time.
Yeah. It can work in real time.
Yeah, it's
so one of the thoughts somebody next door had at the Pixel Core is theater.
Theater, yeah.
Right. I thought Cirque du Soleil was an example, kind of a circus, but it's theater also.
Mm-hmm.
Characters are interacting with each other, but you can look around as they talk to each other.
Yeah, it's not strict rendering-based gaming VR where the characters are actually rendered characters in 3D. It's more like surround photography,
right,
where you only can participate in a point of view change.
In a way, that's superior because you don't get the uncanny valley. I'm looking at a real picture of a real person.
Yeah.
There's nothing like a real picture of a real person. It's a remarkable experience. I've come around.
As the frame rate gets faster, the field of view gets wider, the resolution gets higher, the weight gets lower, and the power efficiency decreases as well. The idea that you can have a personal device, which is yours, that you don't have to share,
right,
that you can bring everywhere in a bowling bag, makes it a very practical platform for people to experience of theater, learning.
I just use it. I want to use it in the gaming. Nursing home. I just want to
right. Sit
there in my chair and have a life without ever leaving
the
nursing home.
Well, this is a picture of the nursing home of the future.
That's what I think. Everyone. We'll all be like Wally, just sitting here consuming our... But, you know, these already are. There's no power in this because the phone does all the
right.
work.
It's just a lens.
It's very lightweight. It's just a holder.
It's a lens apparatus.
Yeah. And... you know, you can get these for $1 if you use cardboard, and this is $25. The Gear VR is a little more pricey. It's $200.
Well, the Oculus, the high-end Oculus...
And by the way, that's the Gear VR is Oculus. It says powered
it's made by
Oculus.
Right. Yeah. Well, yeah, they've been collaborating with them to tweak all the software and everything else so it works well and doesn't burn up the phone.
Right.
And John Carmack has been very hands-on in all the really minutia of the microprogramming that has to go into making that work well.
Of course, the game designer from id who did Quake and Doom.
He's chief technology officer.
CTO over at... He was so excited by this, he said, I want to work for you guys.
And he's been doing a great job. And most of his talks from Oculus are online. They're very technical. So if you're into the technology of it, you can just watch these talks online and become very, very smart very quick.
Jill, what do you think? AR, VR, or both?
So I have a problem with a lot of the technologies in that I have some vision issues that don't always allow it to work for me. Same thing with 3D movies. So sometimes that immersive experience, while everybody around me is enjoying it, I'm kind of like, squinting one eye trying to orient myself.
I have the same thing. I had amblyopia, lazy eye as a kid. It was never corrected. I normally don't use both eyes. I will use one of the other eye. So I normally don't have stereo vision. The eye doctor said, you're a little bit cross-eyed. This is when I was a kid. It's not like you're going to be in TV or movies or anything. But, what happens is you compensate. You learn how to compensate. So I can. I don't have traditional depth perception with stereo vision, but I can match these up because your eyes move, your head moves, and your brain learns to do this. And what's really weird for me, Jill, is when I first went to 3D movies, like Captain EO, remember that at Disneyland? Mm-hmm. I couldn't see it, and I've somehow trained my brain now that I can somehow see it, and now this stuff works for me fine.
That's great.
So maybe there is a way that you can, your brain is amazingly malleable.
There's a VR app that has been designed to correct for amblyopia and strabismus and lazy eye and ptosis.
Yeah.
And it actually works. So there are...
It can be corrected.
There's a lot of therapeutic applications for VR for sensory and visual anomalies that actually have been proven, and they work, and they've been winning awards and prizes in the medical area.
So there's hope, Jill. You and I are going to maybe someday.
Well, I think
I still don't necessarily enjoy it, though.
Yeah.
So let me put that out there. So for the same reasons 3D movies, I don't always find them enjoyable, is because I don't necessarily feel like the experience it's providing me is greater than the experience I had before I had this extra layer.
That's normal, Jill. That's correct. 3D movies suck. Even if you can see them, they suck.
So let me just bring it back to the Cirque du Soleil example you were giving before. I love movies. I really like movies a lot. And I want to see a movie that's well directed.
Right.
I don't want to be the director. I don't want to decide where I'm going to look. I don't want to explore. I want that 2-hour movie to be tightly edited to say something in the way that the shots are composed and the order in which the things are shown to me. So for me, I want my entertainment experiences to be, to have less of my opinion in them. I want somebody else who's very skilled at making them to make them for me.
Yeah, it's like that old thing where you could have the do-it-yourself mystery book, and who wants to do that? Take me through a story. I agree with you on that.
Right, right. You know, when Google was announcing some of the new stuff for Cardboard, I got into a little discussion with people about using Cardboard in the classroom. And technology enthusiasts were very excited. They all told me this would be wonderful technology. It's very low cost, and it would allow low-income students to have field trips virtually that they've never had before. And I was like, bullish.
Yeah, I'm with you.
If you've been in a low-income classroom, I mean, come on, we don't have enough desks. We have to share textbooks. We don't have enough chairs. The teachers wait for students to drop out to have enough chairs for everybody. Like, you think we're going to have smartphones for these kids, and then everybody's going to put their thing on, including the professor, the instructor, and the kids aren't going to, like, start smacking each other in the back of the head? I was like, this is just, you're having unrealistic expectations because you're so in love with the technology.
I am so with you, Jill.
No, I disagree with that. My uncle is a teacher specifically about technology, and he is so psyched for this to become mainstream in the classroom.
This reminds me of a lot of, and I said this actually at the time, of a lot of Silicon Valley initiatives where we're all excited about, we're going to get tablets in every classroom, and then we walk away, and we don't give them any instructional materials, we don't give them curricula, we don't teach them how to use it. It ends up gathering dust in the back of the class.
The devil is in the details.
It's more than just providing the technology, and of course, Cardboard's cheap, but you still have to have a $600 smartphone inside it, and that's not going
to
happen.
I wanted to read you a fact really quick about binocularity, the ability to see in 3D.
Yeah.
So a question often asked is, how many people in the population can see in 3D? The answer varies from study to study, but one of the larger studies suggests about 3% of people cannot see binocularity at all.
Okay,
a further 7% of people have some limited 3D vision, and therefore about 90% of people have good 3D vision. If there are many factors that affect this, there's not one single reason for these variations. So, you know, there are a lot of us that just can't see in 3D.
10% is a big number.
It makes it hard. And so they have a voice. And
wouldn't that be interesting if something, if you're deaf or you're blind.
Right.
But wouldn't that be interesting if there was some technology that just swept the world and 10% of people couldn't do it?
There would be the have-nots.
Well, supposedly Magic Leap, which is the one that Google invested heavily in, it beams the image right into your eye. And they don't like to use that language necessarily.
No, because that sounds painful. Yeah.
But essentially,
it
solves that problem. And you can dial it up all the way to be in full VR or just AR.
So was it your uncle?
My uncle, yeah.
He's the technologist, though, right? So he understands this. He doesn't need to be trained.
Exactly.
Now,
but the kids love it. They did an AR project, and it was open house, and the parents came in and held up an iPad in front of their students or in the kids' picture, and it came to life.
Oh,
and
I love that.
They said the kids loved it, the parents loved it. So he's like really noodling around with stuff like that.
We did a demo, and it's on yesterday's new screensavers. If you get a chance to see it, of something called, was it Spectre 3D? I think it was. It's for the classroom. It looks like a regular monitor, and when you're looking at it, it looks fine. But when you put on passive polarized glasses, like the Real D glasses at the movie theater, the machine has several cameras on the front of it, the display does. It senses you put on the cameras, and it then goes into a 3D mode where you can, with a pen, pick up something, hold it out here, manipulate it, see it. We took the lungs off the heart, went into the heart, went into the valves, watched the valves move, the vessels. It was remarkable. If you haven't had a chance to see it, it's on the yesterday's new screensavers episode.
Is that you trying it?
This is actually on the show. And what we were able to, he has figured out a way, the creator of this, to show it.
That's awesome.
Because normally, one of the problems with VR is unless you're in the helmet, you don't know what the hell.
Yeah.
So he's figured out some way to tape it that we can actually show me lifting the heart out into space. And it's unbelievable.
Regular stereoscopy is being used with the glasses. It's not immersive VR.
It's not immersive. But this is kind of an AR experience. Yeah.
So it's really a limited field of view,
right.
3D, right. And you can interact with it as well.
And this is also for schools, and he's apparently quite a few schools have bought. It's not a cheap system.
It can't be. No.
It's very expensive.
The Z-Space.
Z-Space, that's it. Right. Yeah, you know about it.
Oh, yeah.
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 But I was impressed by it. And you can see kids getting engaged, whether it's better than, you know,
a textbook.
A textbook. I don't know, but boy, if you get that's what it looks like. It's a 3D display without the glasses. But when you have the glasses on, it looks like this. And Jill, I'm like you. I don't see 3D, and I saw this clear. Boy, I was coming right at me. It was amazing.
Yeah, there are a lot of personal adjustments that can be made in the display system to accommodate people that have varying levels of 3D vision support. This one size fits all. You know, excitement that everybody has. Is very early and it's anomalous in its inception, but as the systems get more advanced, they will go through a calibration mode initially for you, the single user, that will take maybe a minute, and then everything that is served to you visually afterwards will have a pre-accommodation for your own particular type of visual senses.
So it could get better and better.
Yeah,
and
none
better.
Of that's going on right now. All that calibration stuff that has to happen.
It feels primitive. In fact, even when you buy the Galaxy Gear VR for $200, it says Innovator Edition. They're very clear. This is a early.
It's a dev kit.
It's a dev kit. Except I'm not going to do any dev. It's really more for me like an amusement park. But it is pretty impressive. Even though you can see the screen door effect because you can see pixels. You're really close. And this is a 577 DPI.
Yeah.
It's a great screen.
Display on my Galaxy S6, but you still see the pixels on here. I don't know, maybe they're not using high resolution.
At Display Week last week was an all-week conference about display technology in San Jose. So all the big players were there.
Oh, I'd love to hear about that.
Yeah, there was a 4K smartphone display where you had all 4K pixels available to you. And so they say that, you know, the VR systems, even this kind of VR system like you're talking about,
like the cardboard.
When you shove a 4K display in there, then you're at the limit of the clarity of the optics. So if you can add glass optics or better optics in there, you can really see all 4K of those pixels. And that makes, you know, a really big perceptual difference. Also at Display Week was a new type of holographic backlighting, which was a physics problem that was unsolvable for years, is they figured out how to do 3D projection holograms, but they required some kind of holographic backlighting that they could only make just 5 or 10 centimeters in a square, and now they can make these new backlights almost any size by using a nanomolecular construction of the atoms of the particular holographic substrate.
I feel like we're really at a breakthrough point. This is
there's so much going on in the display field that what nobody's talking about in the VR business is that all of these display technologies that you see today and you'll have next year or start shipping next year or the year after will be leapfrogged within 3 or 4 years by Moore's Law on a logarithmic curve.
You can thank me, by the way. I just bought Apple's 5K iMac. So it's because of me that you're getting this better display resolution. Because, of course, as soon as I buy something, it's outmoded instantly.
Right.
So what are we going to, what's past 4K? What's the next thing? Is it 8K?
8K, 16K, right?
Why not?
Right. But see, I feel like 577 DPI on the Galaxy S6, I'm never going to see a dot on that.
So what he was talking about, Magic Leap, retinal projection systems, nano displays, plasmonic displays are coming.
Wow.
The plasmonic effect is where, if you look at it like a blue, beautiful blue butterfly, it's just gorgeous the way it reflects light. But if you put it under a microscope, the butterfly's wings are actually gray. There's no color in them at all. And
because they're little prisms.
Because they're cut
diffracting
so finely by nature that they're at an atomic level that they're aligned, the atoms are aligned, that it causes it breaks up light and it projects blue and other colors. So Qualcomm has a whole display division based on what's called the Mirasol display. And that is a plasmonic display. And we will be seeing plasmonic displays in our laptops and our phones.
How do you modify the color? You change
it. Uses available light.
Yeah.
And
you rotate so it's a reflective display.
Yeah.
Retroflective. You rotate the prism a little
bit? Or it can
bit?
Be transparent. It addresses the molecular alignment of the display atoms. you know, basically driving them from the air, from the edges.
Oh, brave new world that has such displays in it.
With this, you'll be able to have a contact lens, which is an AR overlay.
That's
or
what we want.
Occlusive contact lens.
That's what Magic wants to do. That's what we want. Yeah.
There's a company called Innovega, and they're already working on a contact lens, which has
It would be a passive receiver, right. And the incoming light would modify.
Yeah. Well, the way Innovega works is that particular contact lens is polarized, and it also has a very special focal area to accommodate a very, very close display. So if you have a super high-resolution display, but it's only a quarter of an inch or half an inch from your eye, you can't focus on it without having traditional collimating optics, which is glass, compressed, many little lenses, adds a lot of weight, and everything else. So by using the contact lens, it gives you this very close focus area, allows you to focus on that display very close to the eye, and you can still see everything else in your field of view.
I can wear something on my eye that I can focus on.
That allows you to focus at a display very close, like in a pair of glasses.
But it wouldn't appear that way, probably. It would appear like it's out here,
it's
I would expect.
It's huge resolution. It overlays your complete field of view.
Now how do you feel, Jill? That's what you want.
Yeah.
The new 3D. You just put these contact lenses
on. It's called Innovega.
I'll take that. Yeah,
that sounds awesome.
I'll take some smart contact lenses. I was also really excited about Google X Labs was working with on contact lenses that would inject people with the proper amount of glucose if they were diabetic.
Right.
So it would be able to, no, it wouldn't inject you.
It would sense them. It would sense it.
It was sensing your glucose levels through your, the liquid and the tears in your eyes. That's right.
Yeah, the scientist doing that was Babak Parviz. He came out of the University of Washington, and he was one of the lead scientists for Google Glass for a while. And I think he's left Google, and he went back into academia. But his prototype for a glass-based contact lens also had all these other applications that they could use.
So it's not just going to have all these cool AR features. It's also going to tell me if I need to get a little insulin.
Right. It can check blood sugar, heart rate, pulse, all sorts of other things.
Jill, that's pretty exciting. You're not going to have to wear a basis watch much longer.
Yeah, no, I'm all about that. I mean, some of the most exciting stuff that was at CES this year for me were very simple adhesive bandages. Mm-hmm. They're already being used by some hospitals wherein they have sensors in them that read your basic vital signs. They detect if you fall. And it's being used, it's called Health Patch. And it's being used by hospitals when they have a patient who's ready to be discharged, but they don't want to discharge the patient yet because there's something they want to monitor. Now, if you stay in the hospital, your bill is going to go up tens of thousands of dollars every day that you're there. If the doctors can send you home, your care team mm-hmm. can still monitor you remotely. They see a spike, they see a change, they say, come back in, we want to check something out. That allows you to go home, live your life. I believe that the health patch wears for about 2 to 3 days. So it's just a simple adhesive bandage. It goes right on. It can survive through the shower. It's very comfortable. I think this is much, much, much better wearable technology than strapping on a watch that you didn't really know what you were expecting it to do in the first place.
So maybe that's the answer to the nitpicks on the Apple Watch. Is this is a primitive version. We're going to learn about the kinds of things we want to know, and then we'll get
Absolutely.
Better and better at measuring it. You know, that's one of the things Apple's doing that's very interesting is the research kit stuff.
Yeah.
Where they're asking.
And that's part of the phone, too.
Yeah. I think that, so that's exciting. And really, maybe Apple's just saying, we're going to take the long view on this. This is not the final product by any means, any more than Gear VR is the final product for VR. We got to take a break. Jill, I know you only have about 10 more minutes. We're going to try to get this done before you have to run. Our show today brought to you by squarespace.com. Start building your new website today at Squarespace. What a beautiful place. You know, it's so easy to create a website. It kind of breaks my heart because I just spent a lot of money for our new website. And I look at what you can do with Squarespace. It's mobile responsive. That's what you want nowadays. You don't want a separate mobile site and separate desktop site. You want your site to respond to the size of the screen and look great no matter where people are looking at it. Sites look professionally designed even if you don't know anything, even if you don't know any coding. Although if you are a coder, they have a great developer's platform. You just start by choosing your template. And by the way, Squarespace offers you this free access for the first 2 weeks. You can just have the run of the place, even import data from your old site so you can see how it would look. Squarespace.com. Just press that Get Started button. And buy it. This is hosting plus software, state-of-the-art hosting. Nobody does such a good job to ensure your stability and your security, I should add. You know, if you're running your own website, you know you've got to constantly monitor it for security flaws. You don't have to with Squarespace. They do it for you. And it's trusted by so many people, some of the biggest brands in the world. Their commerce is second to none. So many nice features. It all starts at $8 a month, and you get the free domain name when you sign up for a year. You can't get any better than this. Start your free trial today. No credit card required. Squarespace.com. Just click that Get Started button. And all I ask is when you do sign up for Squarespace, and I know you will, you use the offer code TWIT so you get 10% off your first purchase. It is the place to build your store, to build your brand, to put your portfolio, or even just a personal blog. Squarespace.com. Don't forget, when you buy, to use the offer code TWIT, 10% off. I saw you looking at this, Greg. Is this...
So I wanted to show you this while I was here.
Okay, that's President Obama. And now if you... Wait a minute, what's going on here? Here, let's move it down a little bit. What is going on here? He's looking at me and talking to me?
Yeah, it monitors your face.
Oh, as soon as he sees me.
You. Right, so you talking, moving your head around.
That is weird, and you could change his voice, too. What is this called?
So this is Pocket Avatars.
Pocket Avatars.
It's an app that runs on smartphone.
Does it work on iOS only, or this is an Android phone?
Yeah. I don't know about iOS because I don't have an Apple phone.
Yeah, there you go. And then this right now. I'm going to install this.
And then there's all these other avatars that I have here that I downloaded.
So now this is just a toy, though, or what is the larger?
Here's Ronald Reagan.
Ronald Reagan. What is it? Hey, Ronnie. Hey. Oh, hey, wait a minute. He's saying what I'm saying. That's how Dev Null worked.
That's right.
I would talk and the lips would flap. Yeah. Wow.
So this is, it really works today.
Hello. Oh, I'm going to be Ronald Reagan. I got to send a note to Elisa. Yeah. That's great.
She'll kill you.
And you were looking at this Wearality. This is a Kickstarter project. Is this like cardboard or?
The Wearality is a new, different kind of lens, a Fresnel lens that is constructed to give you 150 degree field of view. Very similar to
you're not seeing my
this device, but with a different kind of lens, or a cheap, inexpensive to manufacture.
Yeah, Fresnels are the kind of lenses they use on like street lights and stop lights. They're very cheap because you're not grinding a smooth lens. You're just using. But doesn't it look crappy?
No, it looks fantastic. As a matter of fact, I ran into David Smith, the founder of the company. And it's so impressive that one of his long-term friends and someone I used to work with, Michael Jones, who's been at Google for years at Google Ventures, agreed to be CEO of the company.
So instead of stereo vision, instead of two lenses, you only have one lens. Is that right? Or?
No, it has two lenses, they're just made in a way where they're inexpensive and they give you a huge field of view without glass optics. So... you would shove your smartphone in it just like you would any other lens apparatus, and it would just give you much, much wider field of view for VR, which is, you know, VR used to be a very narrow field of view technology, and now it's wider, but wide field of view is very expensive to make in optics, and this is very, very inexpensive. So
is this 180 degrees? Is it how wide?
150.
150 degrees,
which is a lot.
That's almost all the way around.
Yeah, it's the largest field of view for any kind of a visor or a visor-based attachment for a VR smartphone. Right.
Imagine movies in this. I mean, IMAX is only 110 degrees, right? This is 150 degrees.
Yeah. Yeah.
So this would consume your pretty much all of your vision.
It's very satisfying to put it on and try it. I mean, you really feel like you're someplace else the second you put it on.
Wow.
And
so it's a Kickstarter. So these are the lenses.
Yeah, they raised all their money. They attracted a great CEO out of Google Ventures.
What do you see this being for? Just you won't want to walk around wearing these things. You'd get
disoriented. You'd shove your phone in it. It's just a frame.
Oh, I get it.
Yeah, it's just a frame. And It
but has, you'd have special software.
Yeah,
right,
it has all the specifications that blow past all the other wearable
frames. So really,
frames.
Instead of going to an IMAX theater, I could get the IMAX experience by wearing this with my phone. Yeah. I can't. I don't have to move my head. Yeah. I mean, I'm just looking at it, right?
So there's Alan Kay and Mark Bolas are all very excited about. These are two, you know, leading people in the
I
tech
love
industry.
Alan Kay, yeah.
Mark Bolas is considered, you know, one of the fathers of VR, and he teaches at USC. He's been a friend of mine for a long time.
I'm still not sure I quite get this. So what does it look like? Oh, Vi-Hard. I love Vi-Hard.
Yeah, it's just a new twist on lenses that just popped up, you know, over the last couple of months. And they raised all the money for their Kickstarter.
Is it a VR-like experience?
Yeah. You would use your regular phone using stereopsis, and you would just shove it into this different lens configuration. And it would give you much wider field of view. And it's very light.
It looks a lot lighter than, I mean, the phone is the heaviest part of
it. It's just a little plastic 3D printed frame.
And there you see the little Fresnel ridges.
Yeah, you can see the Fresnel lines in it, but not when you put it on.
Interesting.
So that's
so they can make this cheaply, too.
Yeah, I mean, that's really what's happening in the VR industry is there's lots of little pop-up startups and Kickstarters that are innovating various little areas of it. It's not just Oculus, you know, doing all the work. And the technology, some of these companies are Kickstarter for a little while, and then they get acquired very quietly by Google or Apple.
Right.
And then they're gone.
That's what I find fascinating. This is becoming a battleground for the really big guys. They all see this as the next big
thing. A lot of this R&D has been going on in the dark in labs for years, and mostly universities. USC has got some of the top VR researchers working there now, Scott Fisher and Mark Bolas and Noni de la Peña, who did the virtual Assyria and the virtual news gathering demos, and she's been called the godmother of VR. It's funny to hear all these familial associations of people associated with VR. I was mentored by Mort Heilig, who's the grandfather of VR. And then
whatever happened to Jaron Lanier?
Jaron Lanier was considered the son of VR. Yeah. Or, you know, I mean,
he kind of bowed out, didn't he? I mean, he kind of gave up on it all. He was one of the in the '90s, one of the chief
components. Well, we have two big VR panels at SIGGRAPH this summer, and he's on one of them, and I'm producing the other one with Jackie Morey from formerly of USC.
I have to say, I've come around 100%. It's not exclusive. AR is useful for some things, VR for other things, right?
Well, as a matter of fact, tomorrow the Augmented Worlds Expo starts in Santa Clara for 3 days, and it's going to be a really big event.
By the way, that has an excellent acronym, AWE.
Yeah, right, AWE 2015. So that's still open registration, and they were mostly an AR event, but now they're integrating VR, and they've doubled or tripled in size in 1 year. And a lot of the pioneers and a lot of the head researchers from all the big companies are going to be there, AWE 2015. So I'll be heading to that tomorrow.
What is their thought, what is the general consensus on Microsoft's HoloLens, which is an augmented reality device?
I think everyone's thrilled that they're a player and that Alex Kipman, who's one of their lead scientists, you know, has been actively out there promoting and talking about it at the HoloLens event. And you know, Microsoft is going to bring all of their own smarts to the field, and whatever innovations they have will become known to everybody, just like when Google, you know, opens their doors and reveals products and ideas and technologies. So they're going to be selling product just like everyone else is.
I want to go down to this. This looks like a great conference.
It is. It's going to be exciting. Yeah. It's one of the better conferences that I've been going to over the last number of years. It seems very homey and everyone very familial. Everybody knows each other. All the top scientists show up, and they're either on panels or hanging around. And the VR scene, as far as conferences, has been taken over by the meetups. So you've got the Silicon Valley VR conference, which just happened 2 weeks ago. It was a very big event. And then LA VR is a big meetup, which is coming. The meetups have been growing and doubling in size from one meetup to the next.
Very interesting.
The last one was about 3,000 people in Los Angeles. And everyone is at the meetups as well. So, I mean, it's really very, very hot right now. I predict it'll cool off for a little bit.
You know, I see that Jerry Ellsworth's going to be a speaker.
Yeah, I just saw her at a Maker Jerry. Fair. Yeah.
How's she doing with her cast AR, which is an interesting idea? It's not exactly augmented right. reality. You need a playing field that the
I love the cast AR.
Yeah, it's like for gaming or...
Yeah. It's basically a frame that is tracks your position, and it also has two stereoscopic projectors, micro projectors on it, and it needs a retroreflective material to work. So you can build a dollhouse out of this retroreflective material, or you can just have like a scrim that's hanging up, and it will project stereoscopic imagery in front of you, and as you turn your head, it'll move around and track your head. So if you're using a game just like the Z Space, it works a lot like the Z Space,
right?
Where you put this light headset on, and it's you're not occluded, and there aren't lenses in right. it. Using your real eyes to look out into the real
she
world.
She demoed this for us, and I'm really thrilled that it's gone well for her.
So the idea is that it'll be inexpensive, and it'll be something you could buy for kids at Christmas. And we'll have all these apps and all these little things that come with it that you can project
can
on.
Can all these companies succeed?
That's an interesting question.
No way.
They all seem like there's different takes.
They're little bits and pieces, like little features, right. but nothing all-encompassing for one platform, I don't think. Yeah.
Right. I mean, I could see this being the toy of the year 2018 or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
It feels more like a toy a little bit in the way that this is being used. And yet they did show designers using it and so forth.
My dad had an office in the toy building in New York when I was old enough.
Nothing wrong with toys,
when I was
right?
old enough to crawl, I was crawling around in the Hasbro showroom.
Here's a video. This guy's using it basically as a desktop UI. I mean, it's his Windows, you know? It's his...
Exactly, yeah. So you can use it for complex model intuition and understanding and analysis. So if you have 3D data and you're displaying it in a three-dimensional context, you can actually
get one for
understand
every member
more
of the
family.
Just ignore each other. Put your glasses on. And...
But that's what I like about AR is you don't ignore each other. Yeah. You still see everything that's going on in the room.
So Cast AR has moved down to Mountain View.
Oh, good.
Yeah, so they're in town now.
Boy, I tell you, the product looks very polished compared to what we saw.
Yeah, it's very polished.
She had hot glued everything together the last time we saw her.
It's improved. They're getting
good
close.
Good for her. In fact, I noticed the picture she's using, her publicity shot, is from the Twit Cottage.
Yeah, she did a great triangulation with you.
She is great. Jill, do you need to get out of here? I think you do.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I got to wrap up.
That's quite all right. You're on East Coast time. Great to see you at Jill E. Duffy on Twitter and, of course, PCMagazine.com. And we see Jill a lot on Tech News Tonight and other shows. Always great to have you on here. I appreciate it. Thank you, Jill.
Yeah, thanks for having me, Leo.
All right.
Good
talking
to you.
See you soon.
Bye.
Take care.
Take care.
You.
Bye.
Bye-bye. Let's take a little break. We'll come back. There's some little bits and pieces, kind of the seeds and the stems, the shake that's gone down to the bottom of the show, and we'll get to that in just a little bit. But first, let me tell you about my mattress. Casper. You know Casper. Casper makes an amazing premium mattress in the U.S. for a fraction of the cost. And because they're selling it direct to you, they don't have the showroom, they don't have resellers, you can get a great twin mattress for $500, a king size, all the way up to the top, $950. In a minute, I'm going to tell you how you can save even more. But the question a lot of people ask when I mention this and how much we love our Casper mattress, I sent one to my son in college, is how can you tell if you're going to like this mattress before you buy it? You don't have to. See, this is the problem with the way people buy mattresses today. You go to a mattress showroom, you lie on it for 5 minutes, and you say, yeah, I'll sleep on that for the next 10 years. That is not the way to do it. With Casper, you get 100 days, or maybe I should say 100 nights, to sleep on the Casper mattress to see if you like it. And no questions asked, painless returns if you don't. So there's no risk for you at all. It comes in a box. You saw the size of the box for a queen-size mattress. That's the other beauty part, and that's why we got it for my son, because... he didn't have any way to get a mattress up to the third floor of his dorm, but we could easily get the box up there. The UPS guy brought it. It's so cool, so well made. They're fresh. They're cool at night. You've got a combination of memory foam and latex that give you kind of just the right sink and bounce. It's firm, but it gives, and it's very relaxing. Even Ozzy, you can see Ozzy loves our Casper mattress. I want you to try it. They're made in the USA. They're very affordable. In fact, we're going to save you $50 right now if you go to casper.com/twit $50 off any mattress, Casper, Casper.com/twit. Use the promo code twit. Where was the, I was just talking with Lisa. Got some kids going off to college. Trying to remember where this was. And they said, bring a mattress. I said, wait a minute, don't they furnish the dorm room? Yeah, they do, but they tell you the mattresses are so god-awful, you're going to want to bring your own. I said, what happens to the mattress that was in there? They said, they literally throw it out and hope you leave your Casper there. Hmm. So we're sending a Casper. I forgot who this is, but we're sending a Casper along with them as they go to college in the fall. You might want to consider the same if you've got a student entering school in the fall. Casper.com/twit. Use the promo code twit. It is a great mattress. It's the better way to go. Casper.com. Leo Laporte. We've got Steve Kovach from Business Insider here. We've got Greg Panos, who's been a great resource talking about VR. I knew this was, we wanted to get you on because I wanted, we've had you on Triangulation. If you want to see more of Greg, a whole Triangulation episode with Greg a couple of years ago, I think.
At NAB.
It was, yeah. At NAB. That's right.
Right.
But I feel like we're on the cusp of something very exciting happening. And I only recently got it with the HoloLens. I started to say, wow, this is interesting. And now this Oculus. So what is Oculus? Do you know what Oculus is going to announce this week?
Well, they're talking more about the controllers that they don't have. The interesting thing about the Valve prototype they created what's called the Lighthouse controller, which is a laser infrared scanner that bathes the room in structured light and then allows the sensors on the visor to know exactly where it is in three-dimensional space in a very large room.
So I can wear the Oculus,
right,
and move around.
Yeah.
And now the virtual character I'm playing inside the Rift moves with me.
Or your point of view. Yeah.
But more than that, how do we walk? How do we? And then by the way, I've never got sicker than in my life than doing this. I put on a Rift and I had some controllers in my hand,
yeah,
and I was shooting a gun and I was running through the, yeah, underbrush, and it was the most fun I've ever had until I practically puked my guts out. Because your body's saying, no, you're not going anywhere, and yet your eyes and you're feeling like you're kind of running.
Well, the new Oculus, the Crescent Bay, I believe it is really high resolution, a very wide field
Does
of view.
Fix it?
It helps a lot. Yeah. I mean, really, simulation sickness that people have has to do with resolution.
Not uncommon.
Update rate, yeah, motion disparity, all solvable.
How do you fix the motion disparity?
Well, they're all solvable problems. Latency, reduce latency of the tracking device, yeah, increase the accuracy of the tracking device, the rendering, responding faster to the positional information will solve a lot of that for a lot of people. And as they get closer and closer, closer to zero in terms, right, of latency, then you really have a hard time believing that you're in anything but a real world.
So the Rift, they've already said, will require a fairly high-end gaming quality PC to go along with it. They haven't given a price yet for the Rift, but I think they said $1,500 for the PC plus the Rift, which,
yeah,
means
that
maybe
sounds
$500
fair.
Bucks for the, yeah, Rift. And you're saying that they will add, besides this aluminum style projector, they're going to add, or will they have little, because I've had controllers tied
HTC
to it.
HTC does that with the two controllers that,
yeah,
represent your hands.
So the HTC,
yeah. Otherwise, your hands, they don't know where your hands,
yeah,
are.
Yeah, it's really neat, too.
Yeah.
You feel like you're manipulating stuff,
right,
all the time.
The HTC,
yeah,
controllers have, like, they have infrared receivers or infrared lenses on them, and they're tracking the light in the room.
That's what blew me away better, right, than Oculus.
And the light in the room is being projected,
yeah,
by a very special infrared transmitter that's transmitting like a holodeck-like grid, yep, pattern in the room that you can't see.
Until you run up to a wall, right, and the grid pops up in front of you so you don't
Stop.
Bump your face. Yeah.
There's another company called Sixth Sense, and they have some really accurate trackers too that use magnetic tracking. So it creates a magnetic field, and they have special coils in there that are also tracking. It's very, very high accuracy, mm-hmm, the magnetic tracking. And then the light field tracking, obviously, is cheaper to make and less expensive, but it's also pretty high accuracy.
If you were going to pick a winner, because I do think that there, yeah, will be winners and losers in this.
It's the new console wars, at least for gaming.
Kind
I think.
Of is, isn't,
yeah,
it?
Yeah. It's
and at
Sega
that price,
versus
you've
Nintendo
got to choose
again.
One. You can't. So
oh,
is
totally.
Valve's Oculus Rift, is what Gabe Newell's doing on Oculus Rift? It's interesting because Valve, Jerry Ellsworth was working for Valve when she developed, mm-hmm, Cast AR.
Yeah.
She said, can I take this with me? Because you just fired me. And she tells me that Gabe Newell said, yeah, go ahead, take it with you.
So the Vive is what Valve is developing.
Right.
It's a,
and that's the HTC one, right?
Right, and they partner with HTC on that, and they are starting to ship the dev kits now.
Some developers
so
are getting
everyone I know that's tried the Vive has been really impressed.
It blew me. Compared to Oculus, I've tried them both.
It's better.
Vive is, the optics aren't as good, but like just the feeling, the presence that you're in this virtual world.
So here's the interesting thing. I mean, you just in a span of a couple of months got a chance to try both state-of-the-art systems. In 6 months and in a year, these systems, the scientists that are producing them, will have even better prototypes. So it has to stop at some point where they say, let's produce a product.
Right.
Let's freeze the design.
We're still
in that. Even though we know in 6 months the resolution's going to be double again, the motion latency will be divided in half. And once it gets to a point where people aren't getting sick, they all love it, they're all enjoying it, then they'll be able to say, oh, okay, let's release a product.
Now it's a product.
Well, HTC will have theirs end of the year, they said.
Yeah.
Boy, I wish it were the company
the
that had
more hand-waving that delays it, the better.
Yeah.
Because then the product is going to be closer to the human sensory
system.
They
have the Valve backing them is, or partnering with them rather, is so huge.
Right.
That's because I don't feel like HTC has much life left in it.
No.
I notice you're using an HTC One, which I love. Great
phone.
Great phone.
Too.
Nobody bought it.
Oh.
So
it's got great stereo
struggling.
Speakers.
I know. So I hope, I mean, maybe there'll be a rebirth of HTC. So
no,
the Vive,
I expected
I'll show
HTC
you a little
to do
trick.
That.
No.
I'm going to just take a little.
They do some interesting things with the Sense.
Quick little.
Pictures and all of that.
So, I don't know.
By the way, you didn't mention this. The Pocket Avatars is an Intel software.
Right.
Comes from Intel.
Okay, so here, I just took a picture with a new app called.
Did some breakthrough happen in this space, because all of a sudden there's 800 apps that take your picture, mold it, model it,
here, look at this.
Make you talk.
So it's a it's a computer
you're
vision.
You're gooing me.
Yeah, I didn't get you right.
Normally you could rotate around me.
Yeah, it's a computer vision app that looks at your face, decides on where it's going to place anchor points, and then builds a 3D model of your face and then remaps the image onto the anchor points. It's called Scene, S-E-E-N-E. And if you practice with it, you can...
I could do the same thing. Wait a minute. Let me see here. Let's compare this. Now, don't move, Greg.
What app is that?
This comes with the Samsung Galaxy S6. And what you do is you rotate around the person. Wait a minute. I'm going the wrong way. You rotate around the person so that it gets... It's everything. Basically making a movie, I guess, of the whole thing. And it's building up this 3D model. And then you can, I don't know if I'm doing this right. I have to walk around you to do it.
Yeah,
but
right.
It's really effective. It's a surprisingly effective.
Yeah, this is a subset of that.
Yeah. All of this is like consumer level stuff that's kind of mind-boggling. But again, who's going to be the winner? Do we know? Do you think Valve?
I think HTC has just a slight leg up because...
But Valve's going to be gaming and gaming only, right?
Correct.
Because that's
so
what Valve
if you
does.
Want to look platform-wise, longer view... Maybe Oculus. I don't know if it's
know. Google. You can't bet against
you
Google.
Can't be, not with not magically now that they're invested in that. That's so
you don't
want so to
bet
intriguing.
Against Microsoft. I think HoloLens is very interesting. You really wonder though, where is Apple in all of this? Why hasn't Apple made any announcements?
Maybe I did this
they don't test stuff.
Oh, look,
in a while.
That works great.
John Muir.
Yeah, it's like he's really like John Muir's really there.
Right.
That's
how
neat.
Fun.
Hey, don't smoke. He's saying.
Yeah. Right. Let's see. Other quickies. Nikon apparently has a secret project with iOS. Story from Nikon Rumors, where there's smoke, there's fire. iOS engineers working on a new secret project with Nikon at the main Apple campus that would apparently be a new iOS app from Nikon that would add a special new camera features through Wi-Fi. We've talked a long time about computational photography.
Right.
How the lens and even the sensor isn't what's so important. It's the smarts.
Right.
And tying a very powerful computer, like a smartphone, to a camera really can give you some amazing results.
The combination of the camera and the IMU, or the inertial measurement unit.
That's what you're seeing
that's
there,
the
right?
sensor that knows where the camera is angled or pointing or tilting or rotating. Right. the positional information, in addition to the video that can come into the camera, gives a whole order of magnitude of additional material to be computed that can turn into a 3D database to build a rough model and remap the video or the photo onto the model. So when you're talking about VR in the future, someone will be able to take their phone and walk around you with it and then put you right in VR.
Yeah.
Create a model that will go right into VR, and there you'll be. They'll be able to walk around you in VR. There would have to be another artificial intelligence app that would say, okay, where are the bones in his face? How am I going to organize the animation of the face to work with the bones so he can start talking and then infer the knowledge of how the mouth is going to be moving and map that real time into your persona form or your avatar?
This has been fun. We've really learned. I'm really excited about the future. Hey, we talk a lot. We'll wrap this up with a kind of a fun little promo. We talked a lot about the great book, The Martian. I don't know if you read that. Amazing science fiction story. We actually interviewed the author on triangulation. And right about when we interviewed him, they announced that the Martian had been optioned for a movie to be directed by Ridley Scott, of all people, which is very exciting, starring Matt Damon. And the first viral video promoting the film is out. I think The Martian will be out at Christmas. Let's take a look.
Is it animated or is it?
The Martian is the story of an astronaut who gets stranded on Mars. Here's
look, it's Matt Damon.
Matt Damon as a astronaut.
I don't know what language that is.
Mark Watney. Problem is, he's stranded all alone.
An Armenian?
with a bunch of stuff, he has to figure out how to save his life, get off Mars with the stuff he's got. And this absolutely looks like...
Hi, kids. This is Mark Watney, astronaut. We're about 6 hours before our launch here on the Hermes, and I've been asked by the good folks at NASA to introduce you to some of our crewmates here. Which I'm happy to do. So, hello,
looks like a periscope.
Yeah,
chat going on.
I'm your personal guide on this tour of the Hermes.
Mark Watney's probably the hottest botanist ever.
Astronaut. Is still rolling?
This is pilot Rick Martinez doing the pre-flight checks. As you can see, he's using some pretty sophisticated
I'm looking forward to this.
To get us to Mars. You got enough fingers there, Rick?
Just balancing my checkbook.
Hi there, I am Commander Melissa Lewis.
Dr. Chris Beck, flight surgeon.
My name is Alex Vogel. I am a German astronaut.
I'm Beth Johansson.
I don't think it spoils the book to say...
The computer expert.
...that they do land on Mars. They start to set up their habitat, and then a giant Martian dust storm happens. They think Watney's been killed, impaled on an antenna, and they leave. Turns out Watney's alive.
So he's stuck there.
Stuck there. They can't get back because it's not easy to, you know, turn around. And he's got to figure out how to survive several years till a rescue mission can be sent. It was a really good book. If you haven't read the book, read the book first. And I'm excited about the movie The Martian. It's on its way. Hey, thank you, everybody, for being here. We had a lot of fun. Greg Panos, I got to thank you. PersonaFoundation.org, you want to... promote that? What do you want to promote?
Not really. Yeah, it's
come
just...
back and make a 3D character out of me, will you?
Yeah, well, I would like to do
Let's
that.
Let's bring
be
Dev
fun.
Null back.
Yeah, we could do a lot of fun stuff.
I think that would be awesome.
To turn a new leaf in live radio.
Yeah.
It's become radio, but with characters.
Radio with virtual. I think, in fact, if we could work it out, then you wouldn't have to leave your home in L.A. You could just do the show anytime.
Yeah, right.
By avatar.
Skype in my underwear.
Oh, wouldn't be the first time. Also,
just shoot me.
Not for
from,
you. I'm talking about others.
Just
shoot
me from the top part.
That's right. Just neck up. That's all. I also want to thank Steve Kovach. It's great to see you. We were so sad because I discovered you on your last day practically
last
in San
week,
Francisco.
Last week, yeah.
You moved to New York, but I'm glad to see you again. And
yeah,
anytime you're
glad
in
I
town,
can make it, yeah.
Let us know. And, of course, we'll continue to have you on via Skype.
Of course.
It's just nice to have you in the studio. Thanks to everybody who came, too. A great live audience. How many of you are here for WWDC?
One person. With an Apple Watch on, I think.
Yeah. How many of you are wearing Apple Watches?
There are three guys on my flight.
Wow, four people with Apple Watches.
How many of you are here for Augmented World Expo? Raise your hand, Richard.
Where's the cricket sound? Oh, Richard's here for that. Anyway, it's great to have you. If you'd like to be in our live studio audience, we love it. All you have to do is email tickets@twit.tv. We'll be glad to put a chair out for you. We do the show live, still doing it live, 3 p.m. Pacific, 6 p.m. Eastern time, 2200 UTC on Twit. The new website will be up before we get back together again, but it's very simple, twit.tv. When the new site goes up on Thursday, God willing, and I think it will, you'll see a button right on the front page that says live. You click that, you can pop it out. You can still do all the stuff you do right now on the existing website. It's just simpler, nicer, cleaner, and mobile responsive. Looks great. I think it arguably looks better on mobile than it does on a desktop. But that will all happen before we're back again. But you'll be able to go to twit.tv, click the live button, and watch us live at that time. If you can't, on-demand versions of the show are available also at twit.tv. Should be, I'm hoping, easy to find on the new site. But if you can't find it there, you will find it in iTunes or Xbox Music or the podcast app on your favorite mobile platform. And I know a lot of you listen that way. We also have some great Twit apps, and you'll find those on our website as well. If you look at twit.tv/apps, pick the app that you like, install it on your device, including Roku, iPhone, Android, and Windows Phone. We've got a great Windows Phone app, thanks to Dimitri Lee Allen. Thanks to you for being here. We'll see you next time. Another Twit is in the can. Bye-bye, everybody.